Good morning and welcome to the 10th meeting of the Education and Culture Bill, Culture Committee in 2015. Can I remind all those present that electronic devices should be switched off at all times. We begin this morning by taking evidence on the Education Scotland Bill from Scottish Government officials, the first time that we have considered the proposed legislation. The session will allow us to ask a number of questions, factual questions around the bill, and we will have a more detailed discussion on the policy intention with the Cabinet Secretary in June. I certainly hope today's session will inform those of us who have still to make their written submissions to the committee on the bill's provisions, and obviously we're hoping that there will be an overlap between the Education Scotland Bill work on attainment and certainly the committee's inquiry on the attainment gap. So I think there's certainly work with the bill that will help us with also with our inquiry. Can I welcome this morning Kit Wyeth, Douglas Ansdell, Laurie Meikle and John Paterson. Good morning and welcome to all of you. Can I ask, I don't know who's it, is it Kit, is it yourself that's doing the opening statement, if you want to kick us off?
Sure, will do. Thank you very much, convener. This education bill brings forward a range of measures designed to bring improvements across the education system in Scotland. The provisions in part one of the bill are a key part of the government's overall approach to tackling inequalities of outcome. In the context of education, inequality of outcome is perhaps most clearly demonstrated in the attainment gap, the fact that children and young people in Scotland from disadvantaged communities perform less well in school. Specifically, the bill proposes a requirement that education authorities and Scottish ministers... Specifically, the bill proposes a requirement that education authorities and Scottish ministers attach greater significance to narrowing the attainment gap, making this a priority for all. The introduction of reporting duties will ensure increased accountability both at local and at national level. And these new measures will sit alongside a range of existing activity on attainment. The Programme for Government announced the Read, Write, Count campaign, the introduction of a network of attainment advisers, one in each local authority area, and the Scottish Attainment Challenge. The challenge is supported by a £100 million fund and is being targeted at local authorities with the biggest concentration of primary pupils living in deprived areas. Ministers have also made clear their commitment to creating a secure future for Gaelic in Scotland. And part two of the bill contains measures which will contribute to this aim. In particular, the bill will give parents a right to request Gaelic medium primary education and place a duty on education authorities to assess the request. The bill will also require councils to promote and support Gaelic education, and will require that guidance is prepared by Board na Gaelic on the operation and delivery of Gaelic education in schools. Part three of the bill brings forward a number of measures as part of Ministers' improvement agenda. There are new rights for children under additional support for learning legislation, extending rights currently available to parents and young people to children aged 12 and over who have capacity. A requirement for education authorities to appoint a suitably qualified and experienced chief education officer to provide professional advice on the carrying out of education functions. The introduction of statutory timescales to the Section 70 complaints process. This would address a consistent concern that the current process, under which ministers consider complaints about the failure to carry out education duties, is overly lengthy. Compulsory registration with the General Teaching Council for Scotland for all teachers in independent and grant-aided schools. This will offer assurance to parents that, irrespective of where their children are educated, the standards and quality of the teaching staff are regulated by the GTCS. There's also two technical amendments on free school meals and the entitlement of all children with a guardian to the mandatory early learning and childcare provisions. Neither of these result in any policy change, but they would offer greater clarity and accuracy. So that's all I want to say by way of introduction. We're obviously now happy to take any questions that the committee might have.
Okay, thank you very much, Kit. I'm just going to go straight to questions, and we'll start with Mark.
Thanks, Kavina. I have a number of questions on part one of the bill. Firstly, just like to ask if I could get a clarification on a definition. In part one, section three, a specific term about reducing inequalities of outcome experienced by pupils which result from socio-economic disadvantage. I'd just ask for a definition of what reducing inequalities of outcome will be and how you're defining socio-economic disadvantage.
Yeah, I mean, I think that section 3 of the bill provides that the government will produce statutory guidance, and I think that a lot of that definitional stuff will be picked up in detail in there. I mean, I think that what I would say at this point in time is that when we talk about inequality of outcome in the context of education, I think what we're looking to try and do through the bill is to help ensure improved life chances and outcomes for all of our children and young people in all of our schools. And I think that when we talk about that, I don't think we're looking just at exam results, but we're looking at achievement, you know, in its wider sense. And I think that's very much an integral part of the curriculum for excellence approach. I think when we talk about CFE levels, we're not just talking about the knowledge that children have, we're looking at the skills and the attributes that they have as well. And I think that that's a fundamental part of the broad general education, which takes children through from primary 1 to S3 in schools, is about giving them the skills and the ambition and the know-how to succeed in whatever they choose to do once they move on beyond school.
Okay, you've spoken there about the guidance and the regulation that will be issued along with the bill. Can I ask if there's any consultation ongoing just now with what will be contained in the regulation? Can I ask specifically, as well as pupils who are disadvantaged because of socio-economic reasons, will that guidance cover issue like, for example, deaf pupils who there's an attainment gap between deaf pupils and hearing pupils? Are you able to give examples of what will be covered in those regulations other than the socio-economic reasons?
Yeah, I mean, I think that, I mean, in terms of, you asked first about consultation. We're conscious that these provisions were introduced to the bill without a wide-ranging consultation in advance of the bill being introduced, and we have already been having a number of discussions with all of our key stakeholders about Part 1 in general, but also indeed about how we target the support for children from disadvantaged communities and more widely. The regulation-making power in Section 1 allows us to bring in additional groups of children and young people, and ministers are open-minded about using that power for the bill on introduction. I think there's no decision taken firmly on that as yet, but it is exactly the kind of thing you're talking about. Children with certain disabilities, looked after children from minority and ethnic communities, that kind of thing, where we know there is evidence that children don't perform as well from those groups. And I think, as I say, Minister open-minded about bringing forward the regulations for introduction around that.
Can I also ask what information gathering is ongoing at the moment to establish a baseline so that the government can evaluate performance of local authorities to see whether the attainment gap has actually reduced?
Yeah, I mean, I think the most immediate work that's going on around a baseline is being done as part of the attainment challenge and looking at where things are lying within the authorities that are receiving the funding as part of the challenge. But I think that whatever baseline is put in place for those 7 authorities needs to be one that can apply across the country as a whole, because I think clearly whilst there is that immediate focus given the funding that's there, the focus needs to be across the country as a whole, and that work will be being developed over the next weeks and months.
Okay. Finally, last question is, how will authorities define if an inequality has arisen because of socio-economic disadvantage, or whether that inequality has arisen for some other reason? That I'm thinking about whether authorities will be able to decide that an inequality has arisen as a result of a reason not covered in the bill. Who makes that call?
Well, I mean, I think that's the kind of thing that would be picked up as part of the reporting requirement under the bill. In terms of how local authorities and indeed ministers are looking to focus and target their efforts to help narrow the attainment gap. I think that in terms of the evidence that currently exists, things like PISA, things like the SSLN and other measures, the Scottish Survey of Literacy and Numeracy, and other things that are there to currently measure pupil achievement, pupil attainment, they tend to use the Scottish Index of Multiple Deprivation, and it takes account of where children live in terms of their postcodes, in terms of determining whether or not they are most disadvantaged or less disadvantaged, whatever the case may be. So there is that's kind of a relatively well-established means of establishing where children are from. But I think that obviously local authorities will also want to take account of their own local circumstances in determining which children they feel need particular help and support.
Okay. Check.
Some of the questions I wish to ask have already been asked, but I wonder if I, just in terms of outcomes, I assume there will be no target setting in this whole objective, that we will be looking at outcomes on an annual basis.
Yeah, absolutely, and outcomes, you know, across all of the children in Scotland. I think that, you know, that's the key element of this. I think that, you know, we know that now we're moving into a phase of having national qualifications which are based around curriculum for excellence. They are already starting to take account of that broader CFE approach around skills and attributes as well as knowledge. The work around the developing the young workforce is an acknowledgement, I think, of the fact that, you know, for some children, an academic route isn't necessarily the one that they will go down. And I think that there's an opportunity there to allow those children to achieve well and to prepare themselves for later life and for work, whatever their particular attributes and their particular interests are.
Okay, I should have said good morning, by the way. one of the roles, I mean, I'm glad that we're not going to be target-driven in this particular area. It's important that we look at outcomes. One of the key elements in this, or two key elements across Scotland, is achieving consistency. And, of course, within each local authority area, the appointment of a chief education officer becomes paramount. What skills do you think the chief education officer should actually have?
Well, I mean, I think that what the bill provides for is the opportunity for us to set out in regulations the exact qualifications that a person taking on that role should have. And I think that what we need to...
was to you. What do you think the skills should be?
I think the answer to that question is that it's not necessarily for me to determine that. We've not consulted widely on these provisions before they were put into the bill, and our intention is to run a full consultation on the regulations under that section of the bill to ensure that stakeholders get the opportunity to feed in and to inform our thinking around what those skills and qualifications should be. And I think local authorities will clearly have a key role to play in informing that discussion. It's them, after all, who this provision is designed to benefit by ensuring they have somebody within the organisation who can provide them the advice, the professional advice, that they need in order to carry out their education functions.
But it is important, isn't it, that we achieve consistency, you know, that we don't just look at deprived areas within a local authority area and then find that we have one local authority area that's lagging behind or way ahead in terms of provision. So how are we going to achieve, following on from the question of the roles of the Chief Education Officer, how do you think we might secure that consistency?
Consistency
across local authorities. So that, you know, we're not talking about targets, we're talking about outcomes, so a large part of that responsibility of achieving the outcomes will fall on the Chief Education Officer, which is why I asked the particular question.
Regulations will ensure that, you know, that there are, that those qualifications that are required of Chief Education Officers will be the same across the country. We'll be looking for, you know, a high standard of appointment across all local authority areas. The area where there is a little bit of flexibility for authorities in the bill is that they will have the opportunity themselves to set out the kind of experience and knowledge they will be looking for from an individual who they would look to appoint. But I think the regulations will ensure that the qualifications and skills of the individuals in post will be of a certain standard consistently across the country.
As a secretary to that, if I may, convener, just last question. In the bill, the local authorities have to prepare an annual development plan. I don't know how long these will take, hopefully not too long, which takes account of the authority's annual statement of education improvement objectives. Who audits or oversees these plans, or who will oversee them?
Well, the annual statement of improvement objectives is something that comes from the Standards in Scotland Schools Act 2000, and that's been in place now since I think 2001. They generally tend to be local reports which are prepared at local level and are dealt with exclusively at local level. And I think that what we're proposing through the bill is that there would be a broader duty on local authorities and on ministers to report every 2 years. But that would be a report that would be published locally but would also be brought together nationally by ministers in order to see where things are at, you know, across the piece. So I think that in answer to the question about the existing reports, there isn't, as far as I'm aware, there isn't much auditing around those reports at this stage. Certainly nothing done at national level. They tend to be done more at local level. What we're proposing is that there will be a national level to that reporting process moving forward.
Okay, this is the last, but I just thought. And so what will be the role of the parents, do you see, in the oversight of these development plans?
Well, I think the bill specifically gives parents a role in terms of the fact that local authorities should be working with them and others in preparing their plans around work to close, to narrow the inequality gap. We also think that by asking local authorities to publish these reports locally, they will give parents and others, local, other people within the local community, the opportunity to scrutinise and to comment on the work that they're doing.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Can I go back to some of the earlier points that Mark Griffin was pursuing in part one of the bill on inequalities of outcome? The bill is designed to reduce inequalities of outcome which result from socio-economic disadvantage. I'm not sure I know what that means. I mean, how can I, and I know Mark asked this already, but I want to pursue it a little bit. How can whoever is responsible for doing this, a local authority, for example, understand whether a pupil is suffering from socio-economic disadvantage and that's what's resulting in the inequalities of outcome, or it's some other matter which is resulting in inequalities of outcome? And it's nothing to do with socio-economic disadvantage.
Yeah, well, I think that, you know, certainly we are, you know, as we are currently, I think, you know, in terms of raising attainment across the country, we are very reliant on the professional judgment and the excellent work that teachers do in school. And certainly we would expect that, you know, a given teacher would understand where a given child was coming from, would understand their particular needs and their circumstances and what additional help and support they may need in order to, you know, achieve as well as they possibly can. And I think that, you know, that doesn't change. You know, that responsibility of teachers doesn't...
I won't interrupt. Sorry, maybe I didn't ask the question correctly. But we're putting into legislation, or you're proposing to put into legislation something which says that we will reduce inequalities of outcome which result from socio-economic disadvantage. Mm-hmm. Now, that will be in legislation. And obviously, those who are responsible for doing that surely will have to be able to understand exactly what it is they're supposed to do and who it is they're supposed to do it to. And I'm still not clear as to how that could be done. If you've got a local authority area with multiple postcodes, or in a school with various pupils from different backgrounds and different family backgrounds and different socioeconomic advantage or disadvantage, and you've got various levels of equality or outcomes, in what way will you be able to meet the demands of legislation if you've got to reduce the inequalities of outcome for those pupils who are suffering from disadvantage because of socioeconomic conditions? How do you know what to do to actually meet that bit of legislation?
Well, I think I said earlier, I mean, the guidance will offer greater clarity on exactly, you know, the terms that are used in the bill. The guidance will pick up in more detail exactly what it is that we are meaning by that and exactly how that activity should be targeted. I think that the things like the index of multiple deprivation will be there as an indicator of where these children come from the social economic background that they have. And I think by, you know, looking to measure where, you know, as we do already, you know, the results that we get from that children achieve in school will continue to be broken down by the social economic background that is set out in the index of multiple deprivation. And I think that will indicate to us and indicate to local authorities whether or not they are making the progress, you know, in respect to the particular children that we're looking to target through the bill.
Yeah, I think the difference in my question and your answer is you're talking at a level of the SIMD, and I'm talking about an individual pupil. And what I'm trying to understand is, you know, yes, the overall picture on multiple deprivation may go up and down in various areas defined by postcode, but at the end of the day, it's going to have to come down to individuals and local authorities or individual teachers doing work with individual pupils that they have identified as suffering from inequalities of outcome because of socioeconomic disadvantage. What I'm trying to understand is what will happen at that level, not at the statistical level, but at the individual level.
Well, I think, I think at the individual level, it would, you know, teachers already work well with individual pupils to make sure that they are looking to raise their achievement. I think that, you know, what the bill requires is for local authorities and for ministers to have due regard to those issues when they're taking account of their making decisions around education. And I think that's the key point here. We're not asking schools or local authorities to disregard all other considerations in making those decisions. We're asking them to have regard to this as part of the work that they are doing. Now, individual teachers will know their individual pupils. They will be targeting support to those children depending on their needs and their abilities in any event. And I think that this is just something else that we're asking them to have in mind, something else to bear it to take into account of in making the decisions in providing the support to their pupils.
Thank you very much. George.
Good morning. I'd like to ask a question about who you've actually consulted with, because there's no published consultation on the attainment measures in the bill, but the policy memorandum states, paragraph 25, there is a consensus on the need to work to raise attainment and close the attainment gap. Now, we've obviously had evidence from various parent groups and things like that who say they don't get involved in the process. Have you been speaking to national parents' organisations, COSLA, and also IDES?
Yes, I mean, I think that the provisions in part one of the bill came out as a result of the programme for government, which obviously was only launched towards the end of last year. So I think we couldn't then run a full consultation on those provisions before the bill was introduced. What we have done in the meantime, we've had a number of discussions with COSLA about the provisions in the bill. We've spoken to ADES at great length about them. We've also met with the teacher associations. Well, we met with Education Institute of Scotland. We've also written to the other teacher unions, so they're aware of what we're proposing to do. We've met with the National Parent Forum for Scotland and the Scottish Parent Teacher Council too. So what we wanted to make sure that we'd done was at least have a discussion with all of our key partners about the provisions before the bill came into the Parliament, and there's a full intention, as I said previously, to consult more widely on the provisions under Part 1 moving forward.
OK, then. Has there been anything in your conversations that any of these groups have brought up at this stage with regards to the bill that are they've got concerns on? Or?
I mean, I think that generally speaking, there's at a high principled level, there's generally an understanding that we need to continue to focus efforts on narrowing the attainment gap, and I think there's a principled support from everybody. I think that COSLA did raise some concerns. They didn't feel that the provisions in the bill were particularly necessary. I think they felt that there was a lot of good work going on already, and we should be relying more on that existing work rather than placing additional duty on local authorities.
So just COSLA then? Nothing unusual there then?
I wasn't planning to, convener, don't worry.
That's me, thanks.
Okay, just on this point that George has raised, the policy memorandum at paragraph 25 states there is consensus on the need, as you've just mentioned, to work to raise attainment and close the attainment gap. Now, this is one of these, you know, I suppose, critical issues. You know, if you raise attainment, I mean, do you raise attainment for all or do you close the gap? Now, you say you do both. If you raise attainment for all, does that close the gap? Or do you not just think everybody just moves up and the gap effectively remains similar?
Well, I completely understand your point. I mean, I think the answer to that is, I mean, where we want to get to ideally is that those pupils who are performing at the top continue to increase, but at a slower rate than those at the bottom. So what we would like to see is everyone kind of moves up, but that the gap is narrowing throughout that process.
Obviously, we're taking evidence just now on the attainment gap as part of our inquiry, and something that's come up is people don't understand really what we're measuring, what's out there. Earlier this morning, in answers to questions, you've used the phrase inequality gap, and they seem to be quite interchangeable, except for they're different things and they mean different things. So I'm just wondering, do you mean different things when you say it, or are you using it as an interchangeable word?
So attainment gap and
inequality gap.
Inequality gap.
Because they are different things.
Yes, I think they are.
To a lot of people.
I'm not sure I meant to say inequality gap. I don't think that's necessarily a phrase that I'm familiar with. I think attainment gap, I think we're pretty clear on what that is. I think we're talking about inequalities of outcome. And I think that when we talk about that, I mean, I think we are pretty much referencing the same thing, that what we're talking about is that some pupils perform well and others do less well, and it's about trying to make sure that everybody does better.
Was, obviously, when the phrase was used, it was on the socioeconomic pattern. We understand that there would be inequalities there, but that doesn't necessarily translate to, for every pupil, their ability to learn and to succeed. So what we're trying to get across to people when we're getting evidence is that we're talking about attainment and not where it seems to be the focus is in part one of this bill. Do you agree with that?
I think our focus is very much on, as we just described, I think, on raising attainment for everybody and ensuring that that those who are in the lowest performing groups increase better than everybody else, and I think that's the driving force behind the provisions in part one of the bill.
Liam MacArthur.
Thanks, Convener, and apologies for being slightly late as a result of transport problems this morning. Following up the Convener's question about closing the gap and raising attainment for all. We've had witnesses before us previously who wrestled with this dichotomy. If you're raising it for everybody, then all you're doing is moving the gap upwards a notch. From the discussions you've had with Cosla and Addis and others, is there a feeling that in order to close this gap while raising attainment for all, there needs to be a greater targeting of resources and effort on those who are seen to be underperforming?
Yeah, I think there isn't a recognition.
Sorry to follow that up. Is that the priority of ministers as well?
I mean, I think the priority is around raising attainment for those in the lowest performing groups. Absolutely, but I think that it would be wrong to say that there aren't aspirations around improving achievement for the highest performers as well. But I think the focus is very much on those who are in the lower performing parts of the cohort at the moment. I mean, hence things like the attainment challenge, where, you know, I said this in my opening comments, is that, you know, the focus of the £100 million, the focus of the attainment challenge, is around the pupils, you know, the poorest performing pupils in the primary. In the primary schools.
Yeah, apologies again, I didn't hear your opening remarks, but I think some of the problem around that attainment fund is it focused on areas which ignore those who may be struggling to attain to the full potential in areas out with those that have been designated by the SMID criteria. But your point about aspirations of those that are highest performing, does tend to suggest that, again, those with the sharpest elbows will make most of the opportunities that arise out of this, and actually the gap will not decrease, and if anything, is at risk of expanding more widely. So what in this bill will actually help close that gap, rather than restating the aspirations that, as you fully admit, everybody has had and has had for some time now?
I mean, I think the bill is part of the answer. I don't think the bill is the complete answer to what we're wanting to do around narrowing the attainment gap. And I think that it does sit alongside the things like the attainment challenge, like raising attainment for all, like the Read, Write, Count campaign, and the other work that is going on across the piece. I mean, it is, you know, the bill is one element of the government's work around raising attainment and around narrowing the attainment gap.
Okay. Mary.
Thank you. I won't go on, but I do feel that you're focusing on disadvantaged communities in your opening statement, and the bill states result from socio-economic disadvantage. And I have to say, as a Member of Parliament for the Highlands and Islands, you know, that just doesn't work up there. You could have someone from a, you know, very low attainment living next door to a multimillionaire. And my concern is that that individual is not living in a socially disadvantaged area, and quite often not from a disadvantaged family, if you like. And my serious concern is that that person will be missed out. However, going to my own questions, it's just a statement, but I'm sure that will continue. But I'm concerned at your opening statements. The point that George made on COSLA just before I come, you may have been having discussions with COSLA, but we've got a paper from the 23rd of April, less than a week ago, and they're certainly not happy with what you've brought forward. The duty in Part 1 is unnecessary, doesn't enhance local democracy, it duplicates existing legislation, it's not been consulted on. Why will local authorities report to ministers and not to their communities? So it's fundamentally challenging. It's something we can dismiss COSLA if we like, but it fundamentally challenges local democracy. And why was there no public consultation in what's now the headline section of the bill? Now, I know you said it came through in the programme of government, but I have been here for quite a few years, and it's bad legislation that's not consulted on. So, you know, it's going to lead to a lot of difficulties for this committee as well. So can you maybe give us an explanation about the discussions you've have been having with COSLA, because you've certainly not persuaded them that you've done a good job in bringing forward this headline section of the bill with no consultation.
Okay, I mean, firstly, on your initial statement, which if I may just reply to that briefly, I think that, you know, I think we are conscious that it isn't just children from the most socially disadvantaged areas of Scotland who perform less well. Absolutely, and I think that's why there is that provision in Section 1 of the bill which enables us through regulation to extend the provisions of the bill to other groups of children and young people. And I think, as I say, ministers are open-minded about using that, and clearly if there's a feeling that we should be doing that, then that's absolutely what we will do. I think in terms of the conversations...
The regulations may even come after next year, we don't know.
Well, I mean, again, I mean, you know, if the committee were to ask for, to see those regulations, we could obviously, you know, look to bring them forward. So, I mean, I think that in terms of our conversations with COSLA, I think that, you know, as I say, we have met with them on a number of occasions. I think you are correct to say that we haven't necessarily persuaded them of the value of these provisions. As I said in response to Mr. MacArthur, I think that we see that the bill is one element of our work around raising attainment. I don't think it is the solution by itself, but I think it's an element, you know, to help give it that additional profile, to give it, you know, enhance the focus that is placed around it. I think would be a useful part of what we're doing. The bill provides for local authorities to publish their reports, as well as to report to ministers. And I think that our expectation and our discussions with COSLA have been very much that publishing of reports locally is about enhancing local democracy. It is about enhancing local accountability. And it is about saying to the people in the local authority areas that this is what the authority is doing to help narrow the attainment gap. So there is local accountability there, as well as that accountability to ministers. I think this is a new element. It is a new element. I think that we feel that ministers and local authorities should both be accountable to Parliament for the work that is being done. And that is why we're asking local authorities to provide information to us so ministers can include that in what they say to Parliament about where things are at. I think that national accountability is actually quite an important part of this, as well as the local accountability for which the bill provides. I mean, on the public consultation element, I think that, you know, I don't know, I have much more to say than what I said already. I mean, I think that the provisions have come late in the day, and we've undertaken to do full consultation on them as we move forward, you know, in advance of stage two, and we will absolutely do that. And COSLA will continue to be very much in the forefront of our discussions around that.
Well, I sincerely hope so. Can I now move on? You get a wee rest now to a couple of questions on Gaelic. I was really quite surprised that, you know, I assumed that this bill was going to increase the provision of Gaelic medium education. You know, there's 11 paragraphs on Gaelic. I actually had quite high hopes for Gaelic, but in actual fact, it doesn't create any entitlement to Gaelic medium education, but creates a statutory process to assessing parental requests. So, I mean, what is a statutory process to assess parental requests? Does that just a phone call saying, no, sorry, you're not getting it? Or, you know, what does that mean? And I mean, does the bill intend to increase provision of Gaelic medium education if it doesn't require local authorities to provide it?
Morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. For a moment, I thought I was in the wrong committee meeting, but I'm glad.
No, we've got a wee bit here.
We've got
you.
A wee bit
you're
here,
all right,
so.
Yeah.
And happy to respond to that. There are a few things here that are relevant to your question. There have been parents that have been talking about a right to Gaelic medium education. You yourself used the word entitlement. And as you say, as you point out, the bill clearly sets out a process following a parental request. And I think if we did have a right or an entitlement, both of these would need a process to follow the right or the entitlement. If parents felt they had a right to Gaelic medium education, we'd still have to say for how many children, in what area, can we get a teacher? And as soon as we ask these questions, which are crucial questions for local authorities, we are into a process. And so what we're trying to do is put in the bill a very good process, a process that is consistent throughout the country, a process that is open and transparent, and a process that is timed. Now, none of these things are in place at the moment. A process that will give parents confidence that their request will be responded to. So I don't think we can avoid process. And
a process in place. The Gaelic school in Inverness is expanding at a rate of knots due to parental demand, which, you know, I'm obviously very happy with. But surely every parent in Scotland has a right to phone their education authority and say, I'd like my child to learn the Gaelic language or go to Gaelic medium education. I mean, surely there's a process there at the moment.
Well, every parent may approach a local authority and may request Gaelic medium education for their children, but there is no consistent process.
So, sorry, can I just ask, what's different about this? What's the statutory process? Can you explain?
Well,
I know it's consistent, but What's different about what happened compared to what happens now?
Right. Some parents, without identifying any areas of the country, some parents have been knocking on doors for 10 years requesting Gaelic medium education. And in that request, which has been prolonged, and I think in the Spice report, on this bill, the Spice report also identified that some parents have been asking for far too long, and it comes to the stage where the children they requested Gaelic medium for have moved on and it's no longer relevant to them.
But there's no guarantee they're going to get it.
There is a guarantee that a certain process must be followed in an open, consistent and timed manner.
But the process could still lead to refusal.
The process could still lead to refusal if certain considerations are not met. For example, if there was not numbers and, if the local authority couldn't secure a teacher.
OK, so just my final question, Convener. In the policy memorandum, paragraph 30, the process has the potential to lead to a faster growth of Gaelic medium education. And then you, paragraph 31, local authorities have the opportunity to send children to neighbouring areas. The ways in which these education authorities promote Gaelic is not currently specified. So are you saying if someone, you know, applied for their child for Gaelic medium education, would there be a statutory duty on local authorities if they didn't have the resources to provide that in their local authority? Would they then have an obligation? You've got an opportunity to send children to neighbouring areas. Would there be an obligation on local authorities to meet that parent's demand for the child and to ensure that the child went to a neighbouring local authority in order to learn Gaelic? Is there some guarantee at the end of this?
That is something that happens already. There are already young people that go to other local authorities in order to receive Gaelic medium education. But that wouldn't form a part of the duty on a local authority to send a young person across the border to another local authority.
I'm finding it difficult to find out what's different about this. You know, if a parent has to wait 10 years mm-hmm. and it's too late, you know, how are they going to get their child into Gaelic medium education or at least to learn Gaelic? What's this bill going to do for a parent that wants a child to get Gaelic medium education? What's going to be better than what's already there? I just don't see that.
Well,
I'm seeing a process, but I'm not actually seeing an entitlement or a duty or whatever at the end of the day. Well, that's what I'm finding difficult.
What we'd like to think, this is not just a process, but it's a good process. And it's a good process that entitles parents to submit a request. And as soon as parents have submitted that request, that triggers off a process that has to run through in a certain time, and that process will be open and transparent.
I understand all that, but you've already said that it can still result in refusal.
Yes, indeed.
But you've still got a bit of bureaucracy to see they've gone through the due process. But at the end of the day, is it really going to lead to further demand and further provision of Gaelic medium primary education in the 32 local authorities in Scotland? And that's the final question.
Yes,
it's just I haven't got the final answer I'm looking for. I'm sorry I've had to ask more supplementaries, but I'm asking them because
I understand.
Understood.
Let Douglas answer.
Two parts to the answer. Okay. I'm confident it will lead to a faster growth in Gaelic medium education throughout Scotland. Let me just give one statistic. We have 93 Gaelic early years groups. That's little people aged 0 to 3. We have 93. And we have 58 primaries. There is the potential in parents that have their children in the 0 to 3 to request Gaelic medium primary, and we're putting a process in place for that. Now, you said also it could lead to parents being refused. We're saying that, but you offered that back to me. We felt we had to put a threshold of 5 young people coming forward, and there's a reason for that. Now, if the threshold is not met, if there's only 2 children we thought it was reasonable that in this situation, if there's only two or one or three, it's reasonable for the local authority to look at the procedures and say, in our estimation, or in the process the bill is set down, we reckon that the threshold has not been met, and therefore we will not go forward to Gaelic medium education.
Five people want it, they'll get it.
There's other members want to come in, okay. So I'm going to bring them in now. Liam.
You indicated that one of the reasons the local authority may not be in a position to provide or respond positively to a request is inability to recruit teachers. Now, as a committee, we've heard evidence over recent months about the inability of local authorities to recruit a whole range of teachers in a number of subject areas. We've heard of difficulties in providing the materials for science education, for example, at a primary level and a secondary level. So I think we're painfully aware of the stresses and strains on education budgets and local authorities right across the country. What does this bill do in terms of placing the provision of Gaelic medium education in that list of priorities that education authorities are going to be wrestling with anyway?
Mm-hmm. The bill lists recruiting a teacher as one of the key considerations that a local authority must take into account when it is assessing the request from parents for Gaelic education, Gaelic medium primary education, let me be specific. The bill doesn't take any particular steps to increase the recruitment or the education or the placing of Gaelic medium teachers. We have a range of measures that are being taken forward to increase the numbers of those going into the profession. And they have been quite successful recently. We have seen the numbers of those going into Gaelic medium teaching increase over recent years, and they've been quite encouraging. There are still gaps. It's probably one of the main obstacles that we are concerned about, and indeed local authorities, I think, looking at the provisions of this bill, this would be one of the key areas of concern for local authorities. That's all very well, but can we secure a teacher?
But the government is already requiring fairly specific provisions in terms of teacher-pupil ratios that a number of local authorities in COSLA as a whole have raised concerns about in terms of what they see as a straitjacket that they're being put into. So if you apply this provision as well within this bill, are you not surely just adding to the difficulties they've got to deal with in terms of meeting all of the expectations placed upon them by government?
I don't think we're adding to the difficulties, because the process that we're putting in place in this bill is a process that we put in the hands of local authorities. And as they go through the various considerations in this process, it is for them to look at the very important question, can we secure a teacher? And there will be work to do with Bord na Gaelic about teacher provision in that year. But I think we're placing this consideration in their hands to assess the possibility of securing a teacher.
Question of whether or not they'd be able to secure a teacher, rather than the priority they attach to this as opposed to the other considerations that they are having to deal with in terms of either providing teachers to cover particular specialisms or providing materials to support that teaching provision. The only issue is about whether or not the recruitment of a teacher would be problematic.
No, I think there's a number of issues for the local authority, and we've tried to list them in the process.
Listen to the responses you gave to me very briefly.
This was supposed to be a supplementary.
The concern I have is that this bill is at risk of raising expectations unduly amongst those who've been putting these requests in for some time. It follows on from an SNP commitment in their manifesto to examine how we can introduce an entitlement to Gaelic medium education. So parents cross-referencing that with what's in this bill and the process that local authorities will have to go through, I think there is a real risk here, is there not, that they're going to come away from this thinking nothing's changed here at all. Local authorities will still be able to fob us off, albeit in a tighter time frame than was the case before.
Mm-hmm. I understand the point about fobbing us off, and I think some people will look at things and say that's fobbing us off, but other people will look, local authorities will look at the same issues and say these are issues of substance. This is not a case of fobbing people off. This is an issue of substance that we have to consider, be it teacher, be it cost, be it location, be it a building to house the Gaelic medium education in. And I still think the same point, coming back to the manifesto, the manifesto uses the word, as you referred there to, of an entitlement. And when we've looked at this, when we've consulted on this, we've taken the view that any entitlement still needs an element of process to be delivered and to be considered. And so what we've tried to do here is to deliver a good process that responds to the requests of parents.
A quick supplementary.
I hear what you say about process. I'm much more interested in the entitlement that we allied to. So what are we doing to promote the entitlement as opposed to hinder where we're going by a process?
There's three... In the Gaelic section of the bill, there's three principal areas of interest. The one is parents can submit a request for Gaelic medium primary education. The next...
Forgive me, we've heard that.
Yes, I'm moving on from that.
I want to know what we're doing to promote then, with local authorities the need. Because at the end of the day, I'm interested in the children and the parents who wish to have the service fulfilled, not in the process as to how they get there, although that is important. So what are we doing in this bill to promote the entitlement of Gaelic learning in the local authorities?
I was just moving on from the process. The bill will contain a duty on local authorities to promote and to support Gaelic education. Gaelic education from 3 to 18. It will include a duty on local authorities to promote to parents that they have a right to request Gaelic education. It will also put a duty on local authorities that where Gaelic learner education or Gaelic medium education is in place, that local authorities have a duty to promote it. We will also put, the bill will also contain a duty for local authorities to support Gaelic education. These things are in the bill. They're there as new duties. They will be developed further in the guidance that we prepare, in the guidance that Bord na Gaelic prepares as a result of the bill. This will spell out in detail what needs to be done in terms of the promotion of Gaelic throughout Scotland.
Thank you very much. Moving on, Siobhan McMahon.
Thank you, Convener. Regarding the additional support needs section of the bill and the particular right to extend the rights of children 12 to 15, so my first question is around about paragraph 51 of the policy memorandum, which explains that extending the right to make placing requests to children can mean that children attend a school that the parent doesn't agree with, and so cut across the duty of a parent to ensure their child is educated. Can you explain in more detail what is different about placing requests compared to other rights in that legislation?
Yes, there was concern about the extension of placing requests in the consultation when we proposed to extend all of the rights. The consultation response indicated that there was concern from parents in particular about that extension. The very particular concern is that under the additional support for learning legislation currently, parents and young people can make a placing request to a nursery, primary school or special school, independent special school or grant-aided school in a local authority area, their own local authority area, another local authority area, or indeed to England, Wales or Northern Ireland. And if that right was extended, it was conceivable that a child could end up in a school which was in a very, very different part of the country from their family, and that would be disruptive in terms of the family life. And as a result of that, the decision was taken not to extend that right, both in response to the consultation response, but also in a practical sense, if we'd extended that right, that would be the potential outcome.
Okay, thank you. I mean, it says in relation to that point, though, and the independent mediation services as well, that a support service is being established. Could you give me more details on what that support service would look like? Who would be involved in that?
Yeah, The consultation also indicated that one of the concerns was that if children's rights were extended, that there would require to be support in place for children to be able to use their rights. And in response to that, and in developing the proposals that we've brought forward in the bill, we worked out for each of the rights what would have to be done by the child in order to use their right and what the associated process was. As a result of that, it became apparent that there would be a requirement for four different types of support for children: advice and information, advocacy support, legal advice and representation if a child was going to take a case to a tribunal, for example. And then there's a fourth part, which is that there have been cases in the past where it hasn't been possible to get the child's view independently of other parties, either the education authority or the parents, and therefore it's been difficult for the child to influence processes. And so therefore part of the service will be about getting the child's view independently of others to feed into the processes so that we're clear about what their position is. Our intention, indicated in the financial memorandum, is that we will extend the services currently provided by Children in Scotland through Inquire, which is advice and information services. We'll try to build into a partnership with Children in Scotland those other services, so that the four services will sit under one organisation, in recognition that the child may move between them depending on which rights they're using. So we're trying to bring them together so that the child can move backwards and forwards depending on the service that they need. So there's a sort of consistency of approach to that.
Thank you for that. You spoke about the process in your answer. Mm-hmm. Is it a similar process? Is it the same process that currently happens for 16, 17-year-olds?
Same process.
Okay. And just finally, why was a test of best interest introduced for young people? What is best interest? How was that defined? And secondly, was that consulted on with young people themselves?
Okay. In the best interests part was introduced alongside the change in capacity definition, which we've brought forward. There were concerns that for this group of children and young people, they may use their rights in a way which would undermine their assessed needs. So, for example, an education authority and a family have asked for child's needs to be assessed. It's established that speech and language therapy is required. The child, quite rightly, perhaps has a disagreement with someone providing services for them, a speech and language therapist, for example. That child doesn't want to engage with that person anymore, and that's perfectly acceptable, but they use their rights to try and remove that support, which is identified will help them. And so for this group of children and young people, it was decided that we would introduce a best interests element, and that allows a parent to have an appeal of the child's use of their rights in order to safeguard that their rights are being used in their best interests. You asked about what does best interests mean, and we will bring forward guidance specifically on what does capacity mean, what does best interest mean, and also the assessment of all of those things. That will be statutory and non-statutory guidance, because we want to set out in the statutory guidance the explanation of the legislation, but we also want to bring forward guidance about practice on some of those matters which are new in this area.
I'm sorry, was it consulted on with young people?
Oh, sorry. The original consultation, which was on the principles of whether or not children and young people should have rights, was consulted on, but we haven't consulted on these specific provisions with children and young people. We have discussed them with a range of stakeholders, including the National Parents Forum, ADES, COSLA, and others that you would expect, but not children on this aspect.
I know I said finally, but are you going to? Is that in a plan? Or?
When we bring forward the guidance and the regulations associated with the bill, we will consult on all of that.
With young people?
Yes. Oh, yes, absolutely. With children, yes.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Gordon MacDonald.
I just want to continue this discussion and more about the practicalities of extending these rights to children 12 to 16. So you've said it's important that we get the child's view, and it absolutely is, but how would their view be taken into account, and what weighting would their view have in arriving at any decision?
In general terms.
These are all questions in general terms.
No, in general terms. I was thinking more in case, for example, in mediation, there would be a specific element there. The the purpose, the way that it would be taken account of is that in, as part of the decision-making process, alongside the parents' view, alongside the education authority's view, alongside all the people that would be making the decision, it would have equal weighting to all the others. That's the intent. It's what, you know, we wish that children are able to influence the provision that is there for them, and therefore there would be equal weighting as part of that.
So they would have equal weighting.
Yeah.
And it says in the memorandum that the bill would extend rights to children between 12 and 16 where the education authority considers that they have capacity. How will the education authorities assess whether they have capacity, and who will make that decision that they actually have the capacity to exercise those rights?
We will bring forward guidance on how that assessment will take place. In our consideration of these matters, we're aware that there will be a significant amount of information available from the child's records, from the experience of teachers and the family who know the child well, for the 11 years and plus that they have been part of the system. And there are circumstances in which it will be extremely clear immediately whether or not the child has capacity or not, because of that information. In some circumstances, that won't be immediately apparent, and there are other elements already within the bill which allows assessment to take place, and we would those would be enabled in order to make a specific assessment. So, for example, a psychological assessment in those cases. We are expecting that, for the most part, however, that the information that is already available about the child would be used by the education authority. It's the education authority that's required to make the decision to come to that view.
And my final question is, you said that children's view and parents' view would have equal weighting, but, you know, if there is a degree of disagreement between the child and the parent about the correct way forward, whose view is paramount?
In the circumstance where the child is using their right in a way which the parent disagrees with, there is within the bill the provision to allow the parent to make an appeal of the child's of capacity decision and the best interest decision, and that is the way in which the parent would be able to ask for that review of that the use of the right to make sure it is in the best interest of the child. So although the two rights sit equal, there is a practical measure to safeguard for parents that the child's use of the right is proper and in their best interest.
Okay, thanks very much.
Okay, thank you. Liam MacArthur.
Thank you very much. Just following on, in terms of Section 19 and the powers under the 1980 Act to bring complaints to Scottish ministers about education authorities failing to undertake statutory education duties, I note that the bill's proposing to restrict those further, I think specifically in relation to the ASL Act 2004.
Yes.
It's also setting out, I think, some sort of specific statutory process, or part of the complaints process to fall under statutory regulation provision. There seem to be fairly limited numbers of complaints that have been made, so I'm perhaps struggling to understand what the demand has been to restrict the provisions further and to further kind of set out statutory specification of the process. Can you maybe enlighten us?
Yeah, absolutely. There have been cases in the past where Section 70 complaints, particularly around additional support for learning, have been used to submit complaints about matters which are within the remit of the tribunal. The Additional Support Needs Tribunal, sorry, for Scotland. And so there have been circumstances where Scottish ministers have been considering matters for which there is a specific body set up with expertise to consider those matters. And there are difficulties in that Scottish ministers may make one decision on that matter, but the tribunal would reach a different decision, potentially. And both of those can be appealed to other legal bodies at a later point. And so to be absolutely crystal clear, but also to ensure that we make use of the body that's designed for the purpose. We have chosen to restrict the matter, the Section 70 complaints, only in relation to the matters which can go before the tribunal, and all other additional support for learning rights. Anyone could still bring forward a Section 70 complaint, but in those ones around coordinated support plans, placing requests, etc., we want them to go to the body that was established for it. So we have brought forward that amendment. In relation to the point that you asked about why timescales, there was some concern about the length of time that Section 70 complaints were taking to be concluded, and there was some dissatisfaction highlighted by parents about that process and about that system, and we had brought forward some proposals to try to resolve those concerns. We consulted on those proposals, and the consultation wasn't favourable towards those, so we have tried to address the original concerns by bringing forward timescales to try and reduce the length of time that complaints take in this area.
What's the likely impact on the number of complaints that have been brought forward by taking ministers out of processes that actually should be more rightly dealt with by the tribunal?
We have had... there have been five complaints on one occasion where there have been five complaints linked together in that type of matter. All the rest have come forward, so that we don't think that this will create a reduction in the normal running of Section 70 complaints. Parents would usually choose the tribunal as a matter of course. You know, there are a far higher number of complaints going to the tribunal around these matters than there are for Section 70.
The reason they were coming to the ministers was a confusion as to the way in which the tribunals worked, or was it chancing their arm that they didn't think necessarily they'd get the response from the tribunal, so went down the ministerial route?
I believe it was that there was a belief that, you know, that you're bringing this matter to the minister's attention, and I think right. That was the attraction right. For it in those particular cases. Right. And the case is slightly more complicated because the cases were linked together to try to establish a systemic failure in a particular area. So that it's slightly more complicated than I'm perhaps setting out for you.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, thank you. Can I move us on to the section of the bill which is about independent and grant-aided schools and the issue of registration? My understanding is the policy intention is there's a requirement that all teachers who will be at working in independent and grant-aided schools will have to be registered with the General Teaching Council for Scotland. I think that may have come as a surprise to some people that they weren't already registered with the General Teaching Council of Scotland. But that aside, Can you enlighten the committee, because you talk about the phasing in of this particular policy, how long that phasing in is likely to be?
Yeah, I mean, I think that, in terms of the numbers, which I think will influence the phasing of the new requirement, we understand there's around 730 teachers at the moment working in independent schools who don't have DTCS registration. Now, about two-thirds of those are likely to have other qualifications, which would mean they would be unable to immediately register with GTCS were this requirement to come in.
The 730 who are not registered with the General Teaching Council of Scotland?
Correct.
Out of a total of?
Out of a total of around about 4,000.
Right, okay. Sorry.
So it's okay. So there's around about 200, just over 200 who we think would need to get a qualification in order to then continue to teach in those schools. So I think our expectation is that a period of around about 2 years is when we would expect that number of people to seek the qualification they would need. Therefore, the actual requirement would kick in a concrete fashion a couple of years after the commencement of these provisions.
What we're talking about here is the 730, roughly, who don't register, but you're expecting around about 500 or so of them, 500 plus of them, can effectively get automatic registration as soon as they just haven't applied. Would that be a fair way of putting it?
Correct, yeah.
Okay, so we're talking about a relatively small number of around 200.
Yeah.
Do we know what range of qualifications these individuals have? I mean, are they totally unqualified? Do they have some qualifications? What do these individuals teach?
Yeah, I don't know that we know the answer to that question. We can certainly look to try and find some more information and write to the committee if that would be helpful.
Well, I'm just curious as to, you know, that there are 200 plus individuals teaching, yeah, albeit in independent schools, without qualifications or with qualifications which don't at the very least are an equivalence to allow them to be registered almost automatically with the GTCS. That sounds, I'm just slightly surprised by that. Yeah. And I'm just wondering what level of qualifications they do have. But so I'd be interested to know what information you do have on
sure.
that.
Okay, we'll follow
My
up.
My second
that.
Question is about the policy memorandum, and it talks about discussions you've had with key stakeholders at paragraphs 104 to 106. And I'm just wondering whether or not there's been further updates since the publication of the policy memorandum on this issue, and what those discussions have been about and led to. Because I'm thinking of questions like, you know, how does it impact on the ability of those independent schools and grant-aided schools to actually operate? Are they supportive of the changes? Does it particularly impact on certain schools as opposed to other schools, or is it evenly spread across all of the schools?
Yeah, I mean, I think that the conversations that we've had predate the publication of the policy memorandum. We've not had any further discussion since then, and I think that we spoke with the Council for Independent Schools at that time. I think they were supportive in principle of GTCS registration for all the staff. I think the intention is, I mean, what the bill provides for is for us to make amendments through regulation to require this, and those regulations are actually, certainly in respect of independent schools, are affirmative regulations, so there will be a full consultation with all the schools and others affected by that as part of that process before those regulations are brought forward. So that's kind of an ongoing process rather than one that's happened already.
Okay, just again, I mean, are you aware of whether or not this is an issue which just affects it roughly evenly spread across the independent sector, or is it particular schools that have, you know, a lot of unregistered teachers?
I think that in the main, most of the independent schools that we're aware of have the vast majority of their teachers already GTCS registered, or will be able to get that that requirement quite quickly. But I think there are potentially a small number of smaller schools who generally won't have a majority of staff in that
situation. That's what I was getting. I was wondering whether it was yeah. affecting some of the larger schools, or was it particular some of the smaller schools that perhaps this problem...
I think it's more likely to impact more on the smaller schools, yeah.
OK, well, any further update you can give
sure.
us would be yeah. welcome. Can I move on now to Colin? Give some questions.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to come back to the post of Chief Education Officer, and I'd like to pick up on a couple of the comments that were made earlier on. Section 20 of the bill requires education authorities to appoint a Chief Education Officer with experience and qualifications as set out by the Scottish Ministers and Regulation. Earlier on, in response to a question from Chick Brodie, the comment was made that it's up to the local authority to decide on experience and qualifications. It seems like there's a little bit of a conflict there.
Okay. Apologies if what I said was unclear. I mean, I think that what Section 20 provides is that it says that an officer appointed must have the qualifications prescribed by ministers in regulation. So that's quite clear. The ministers set the qualification. And the experience that the authority considers appropriate in relation to carrying out the functions that are provided there. So it's a mixture of the two. It's for ministers to set out in regulation the qualifications, and for the authorities taking account of that, to also to consider the experience they think is appropriate for that person in their local area.
Are we looking for the Scottish ministers to sort of lay down the baseline, and the local authorities then add to that according to what they need locally?
Yeah, I think what ministers are going to set out is the statutory, you know, the qualifications that they must have in order to carry out that role. It would then be for an authority to make an appointment based on, you know, candidates who meet those criteria according to the experience and the skills they feel are particularly appropriate for them locally. It may be, for example, that they have candidates coming forward who have particular experience of working in an urban area. If they're in an urban area, they may feel that's most appropriate for them. It's for the authority to take some of that into account in determining their appointment.
Again, earlier, we talked about the role of the Chief Education Officer, and you stated that it was to provide advice.
Yeah.
So they wouldn't have an operational role. They're there to provide advice, so presumably they're a centre of expertise. Who do they give advice to?
The idea is they would give advice to the council. I think that education legislation has changed quite a bit in recent years. It's quite a complex landscape, and I think that part of our thinking around this is that it's useful for the council to be able to draw on advice from a senior officer who can actually, you know, understand that landscape and give them the advice they need in the carrying out of the council's education functions.
So would this be an independent role, or would it be a role reporting to the Director of Education?
That would be for the council. We're not going to prescribe exactly where within the local authority hierarchy that individual should sit, but they will be within the local authority.
Now, presumably you're not envisaging that there's going to be 32 new appointments of senior staff at considerable expense. So would local authorities be within their rights to appoint an existing officer into this role?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I think that in the majority of cases, most authorities already have people carrying out that kind of director of education role who would have the kind of qualifications and experience that the bill envisages. And I think that, you know, where that doesn't exist, that's what the bill is trying to plug that particular gap.
What circumstances would trigger the advice that you talk about? Would it be if the chief education officer's asked, or would it be would he or she have the right, some sort of statutory right of input?
No, I mean, I think it would be just generally around informing the council around its carrying out of its education functions. So it would just be part of normal council business to seek advice from those within education in the way that they do at the moment, seek advice from those involved in social work and other areas of council business.
So what value is this actually adding?
Well, as I say, I think that the view that's been taken is that it's important to have somebody within the council who has the qualification and experience to provide that advice on the carrying out of education functions.
Shouldn't councils already have that skill, these skills?
I mean, I think that, as I said, I think in many cases they already do. I think that the point that was made to us, and this, you know, we've had a number of discussions with ADES about this, who are very supportive of this provision, and I think that the point that was made to us is that, as has happened in a number of authorities in recent times, they've tended to rationalise the number of senior managers they have. Directors of children's service, for example, are quite common, as opposed to directors of education, that kind of thing. And I think that the intention is that education and advice around education issues is put on a similar footing to that of social work to ensure that the council has a qualified individual within the organisation who is able to provide advice on its education functions.
Mm. Now, there's been no formal public consultation on this, although I know some stakeholders have been involved and expressed their opinion. What were the key issues that were raised in the discussions with stakeholders, and why was there no public consultation?
Like the attainment provisions, which we've already discussed, these provisions came up fairly late in the day. That's why there's not been full formal consultation on them at this point in time. I think that, again, generally speaking, I say, well, ADES are very supportive of the provisions. Other stakeholders have generally been supportive of the introduction of this post. COSLA have advised us that they remain to be convinced of the need for this post.
Now, there used to be the post of Chief Education Officer, but it was abolished back in 1996. Have things, what's changed? I mean, this post was deemed unnecessary then. Mm-hmm. What's changed that it's necessary now?
Well, I think it's the two things that I referred to. I think that partly it's about the rationalisation of local authorities, given the funding constraints under which they're operating, and the need to ensure there is somebody within the council who has that education background. And the second thing is the complicated landscape around educational legislation. And related legislation as well, which we feel it would benefit local authorities to have that professional advice within the council.
I'm just a little concerned. I mean, I said before that you would expect councils already to have this level of expertise in connection with education, and does this imply that there are some councils that are falling short on that and that need this advice, that need this extra expertise?
I mean, certainly not that we're aware of. As I say, I mean, I think the rationale behind it is to formalise that position within the council and to ensure that advice is available in all occasions, both now and in the future.
Okay, just before, I know Liam wants in a supplementary, but just before I come to that, I'm slightly confused now because I think you've said slightly contradictory things there. You've said that in response to two questions from Colin, one, that all this is doing is formalising the process of expertise that's already there. That was towards the end there. And early on in one of your answers, you said
to the question about whether his expertise was there, you said, you know, some authorities have it, which suggests that some don't. Which one is it?
We're pretty certain that all authorities do have that expertise within the council. It is about formalising it and putting it on a statutory footing.
So, in your view, they all have it, and you're formalising the process?
Yes.
That would be the... Okay, Liam?
I was generally along the same lines. I share much of Colin's confusion about what we're seeking to achieve here. You suggested that many councils have it, and then in response to the convener, you've suggested that all have it, but perhaps in a different guise. I think I would have concerns that we appear to be legislating for something where there isn't a need, and the consoling fact that the Association of Directors of Education want a statutory requirement to have directors of education is going to surprise absolutely nobody. But we legislate where we need to, rather than just because it makes us feel slightly comforted. I mean, I think from the responses you've given to Colin and to the convener, you've assured us that all local authorities take seriously this requirement. They may provide it in slightly different ways, but have access to that expertise already. And therefore, why are we being asked to put on a statutory footing something that is being delivered already?
I understand what you're saying. I think I've outlined the rationale behind the provisions being in the bill. I don't think I've got anything more to add to that.
Right. Okay. I'm sure we'll come to the policy question. I'm sure we'll come to the policy question when we have the Cabinet Secretary. So, George, did you have a supplementary? Yeah.
Chief Education Officer, again, are we not getting a wee bit kind of caught up in structure here? Because the whole idea is that the Chief Education Officer, I understand what you're saying when you say many of the departments and councils are now directors of children's services, and there's a whole idea, yes, the expertise is there in local authorities, but it's a case of having someone whose sole responsibility and is an expert in education, because not all that director of children's services is not always someone from an educational background. Is that not the case that we're looking at when we're talking about the Chief Education?
That's absolutely correct, and I think that's part of the rationale behind making sure there is a clearly identified individual who has those responsibilities within the council, be it that director of children's services or somebody else.
Okay, thank you very much for your attendance this morning. That was obviously our first run at the Education Scotland Bill. Before I close or before I suspend the meeting, I should have said at the start that obviously today is the start of the SQA exams for pupils across Scotland. I know that pupils this morning have been studying higher drama, and today will also be studying higher economics. So on behalf of the committee, can I wish all pupils who are studying exams today and over the next few weeks the best of luck with their exams, and I'm going to abuse my position and say good luck to my daughter, who's sitting in higher drama this morning. She's in the exam at the moment, so she won't hear this until later. But I'm sure that we all wish all pupils across Scotland the best of luck in this, what is always a stressful time, both for pupils, parents and teachers. So good luck to all of them. And can I suspend briefly? Moving on to agenda item two this morning, we are looking at educational attainment gap and particularly in the role of sport and the arts. As part of our work on educational attainment in school, we wanted to drill down a little bit in certain areas. Last week we looked at the construction industry. This week, as I said, sport and the arts. In terms of raising attainment, we have talked about the attainment gap and closing the attainment gap and what the attainment gap means. So hopefully we'll get some more detail on that this morning. And of course, that we want to focus not just on examination results, but attainment in its wider sense. There does appear, and certainly I think it is fair to say, slightly limited academic literature on this particular area about the impact of sport, arts, etc. on the attainment of pupils. So I'm hoping that we'll have some practical examples today from our witnesses. Can I begin this session by welcoming Brian Caldwell and Stephen Gallacher from St Mirren Football Club. Donald Gillies, unfortunately, is unable to be with us this morning, so Chris Smith. Thank you, Chris, for stepping in late on from the SFA. Colin Thomson from the Scottish Rugby Union, Graham Main from Electric Theatre Workshop, and Ruth Wishart, who's a broadcaster and journalist. So thank you all for coming along. Can I say to the two gentlemen from St Mirren Football Club, given there's two from St Mirren Football Club, any questions that you wish to answer, I would ask that one person from St Mirren Football Club answers the question. I don't mind which one it is, but you're not getting two bites of the cherry. I'm sure St Mirren fans would love to hear from you, but if just, and I'm thinking of one person in particular, but if just one of you answers, given the six people on the panel, we want to get through this as quickly as possible. But I'm going to start this morning's questions from George Adam.
Yeah, good morning, everyone. I wanted to ask these have this session mainly because I think sport and the arts can contribute so much, because one of the things that we're getting in our evidence at the moment is the fact that we're having difficulty engaging with hard-to-reach children and young people and hard-to-reach parents, and we need to get both involved in order to push educational attainment forward. Now, I know from all your organisations there's various work you do on this. Can I ask you, can you give us some evidence of some of the young people and parents that you've met during doing your work that you've actually had positive outcomes in, like possibly going down the route of a career path or other parts of education?
I'm obviously work with St Mirren Football Club, but I do a programme called Street Stuff, which is a partnership programme between St Mirren, obviously, Renfrewshire Council. The programme itself it started off as more to work with young people in more harder to reach areas, to get them away from the so-called youth disorder, antisocial behaviour sort of background. As the programmes went on, probably 6 years down the line now, 48%. The young people involved in our programme are staff members. So we've basically took the kids who've been dropping out of school, been causing trouble, to become the member of staff to run the programme. But in turn, it's helped reduce youth disorder collectively around, but it's gave them that positive outcome as well. But not only that, it's also gave the parents that sort of feeling that the kids are doing well. Now they've got somewhere to go, they're not having to go, but they've not got a job. They see there's a positive place for them to go. So that's the programme we're working away with at the moment.
See, from your own perspective, you obviously, St Mirren Park, the new ground is actually in Fergusley Park, which is an area we constantly hear about as the biggest, largest area of deprivation in Scotland. Have you had quite a lot of involvement with the young people in that area to try and help?
There's a few examples. Like every Friday and Saturday night, you know, we've got probably 50, 60 kids that will turn up between 6 o'clock, 10 o'clock to turn up and play football on both nights. But just the other week there, we managed to take 10 kids from that area in their first ever trip out of Fergusley Park, and we took them for a week to London. And it was the whole culture thing change, you know, that it's that first time in the tube, first time out the city, first time out of Paisley, you know, and the parents, the panic of them, oh no, what are they going to be like? But the kids to see down the street, up close, you know, all these kind of things, it was like it was really, you know, it was an exciting time for us, but for the kids, the memory, you know, will last on as well. But these kids are turning up at us every week, you know, coming to the football club, seeing that there's somewhere for them to go and something else to get involved in, which is probably something they've never had the chance to do. So it's using football again, my sport, should we say, to get involved in something positive.
OK,
because a lot of your clubs now, you do have it's about 50-50 with young men and women. Yep. Now, and you have dance classes and things like that as well, so that kind of crosses over the, you do a lot of the culture side. Yep. As well,
there's a few that the dance part's really taken off. We've done an evaluation from UWS. They came in and they obviously spoke with the kids, and the kids were telling us what they wanted to do. So instead of us changing the programme, which we tend to do, oh, we'll do the assessment, what they want, the kids spoke. We want this, we want that. Dance is one of the big things. So we've got a programme now where the girls are turning up more than the boys. So there's one of the venues, there's over 100 kids turn up on a Friday night, but 60 girls, 40 boys just to do dance. Still got the football part of it. That's coming along. It's been more successful, but we're trying to get more of the kids to take and lead the sessions, you know, the way that they like to do it, under the watchful eye, obviously, that are the trained coach.
Can I ask the other groups, with regards to the positive outcomes you've had in working with within these type of hard-to-reach young people?
Pretty happy that. There's loads of evidence across the board. I think the programme that I manage, the School of Football, we have, in particular for myself, for the South East region, I look after five schools, and all five schools sit in really difficult areas. Probably one of the most difficult at the moment is Craig Royston High School, and we have a link there with Spartans Football Club, and a lot of the young boys and young girls who take part in our programme actually attend Spartans Football Club on a regular basis. Now, they run a number of different programmes, whether it be a footy club on a Friday night, whether it be they have the young boys and girls going in there and working as ambassadors for the club for various different venues and various different events. So that'd be one first and foremost, and that's not really looking at what academic qualifications are going to achieve, but what they're going to do out with football first off. So that'd be the first one.
Okay. We've got several programmes throughout the country, mainly funded by cashback funding. We have 30 schools of rugby that are operating across the length and breadth of Scotland. We also run what was street rugby sessions, which have now morphed into referral programmes. We found that the street rugby sessions were, in some cases, a bit hit or miss. You had to take the word that the children were going to be there on that particular night. So what we've done is we've worked with campus bobbies, we've worked with local social work, we've worked with the referral teams within schools and within education. And I circulated for the committee a paper on an example that we ran at Braeview High School and Craigie High School. That's typical. We've got 15 such of these programmes running, where it's children who are at risk of dropping out, who are referred to us by the guidance staff or indeed campus police. They go through a development programme where we use rugby to teach wider skills, so wider skills of teamwork, respect, engagement, communication, life lessons, and through that, similar to many other programmes that we've heard about, take them on a journey to then qualification, working in rugby, playing, continuing in rugby and continuing beyond that. From all the programmes we've run, what we've found, you know, experiences of young people and indeed adults around about these young people, where they've been most successful is where we have had partnership approach between PE staff, school staff and delivering staff from rugby. And, you know, so we could, as Scottish Rugby, could give you lots of examples whereby Scottish Rugby has done this, but what I'm saying to this committee is that where you think PPAS, PE, physical activity and sport, that's when it has the maximum return, it's more sustainable, it's because education are buying into it and the school are actually buying into it, and that usually comes from the head teachers. So if we have a head teacher, so if, for example, if I think about Maxwell Town High School down in Dumfries, very positive head teacher who's come and spoke at the Parliament here when we had our Scottish Rugby parliamentary reception, and she talks glowingly about the impact that the rugby programme has had on her children and her small community down in a deprived area down in Dumfries. The impact for the children is huge. Attendance, attainment goes up. Achievement goes up. But also, the drift into the local rugby club also goes up as well. And, you know, within the last 3 years, we've taken that school from having one team to now having four, five teams. And so what I guess I would like to put over to the committee is that where you have good partnership working between a sports organisation or indeed an arts or other organisations with education, it does work, but it has to work in a sustained way, year in, year out, rather than it being an initiative that stops when funding stops, or an initiative that stops because the initiative that's been led moves on. So,
before
come to the arts. I know that Mary, you wanted a question, I think, on rugby.
My question fits into Colin, am I right in saying that when you gave evidence to the Health Committee many years ago in Pathways into Sport that you spoke about physical literacy?
Yes, I could have done.
Well, I think you might have done, and I feel that it perhaps fits in here. But it was just the Scottish Rugby paper convener. That was the only question I wanted to ask. The things I was very impressed about was the... Yeah, I don't want to read them out, but, you know, all the natural benefits of this project. The second thing I was really pleased about, and we're looking at attainment here and people from disadvantaged areas and communities, was your partnership with the High School of Dundee, because many of the schools in Dundee would focus on football rather than rugby. I just wonder if you'd say a word or two about that. But the one thing, convener, that I thought was missing from your excellent paper was there was no word about parents. And I just wonder, you know, when you've got kids, you know, did you find the parents got involved? Were they supported? They're not mentioned at all. And I just wonder how... Does this help bring parents into being more supportive towards their kids or whatever? So really on the partnership with Dundee High School, the physical literacy, because I think that's very important to what we're looking at, and the parental involvement, and I would perhaps ask if the football side would respond to that. That's all.
Okay, so physical literacy. I hope I don't contradict what I gave to a previous parliamentary session.
I probably wouldn't remember.
This goes back to the sustainability element. Physical literacy, like anything, is sport, the arts, music. Many stone ago, I was a PE teacher, and one of my education philosophies was that if you have a reason for a child to go to school, educating them is pretty easy if they have a purpose. Now, for many people, that purpose could be maths, it could be English, it could be arts, it could be drama, it could be sport. And if you have a reason to go to school, then the other things become easier because they've got a purpose to go to school. If we go back to the physical literacy, if you're teaching children from, just like you're teaching maths, English, there's a long-term approach to it. And very often within sport, we have a short snap of activity that then tries to lead on to something else. If you do not have a physical literacy approach where you, just like English, you learn the A's, you learn the B's, you learn the C's, and then you get up to an age where you're 15, 16, that you feel physically confident and competent to take part in whatever activity that may be. If you don't have that, you're never going to get it. And so this is where the physical literacy and the longer-term sustained approach is very important. If you do that, then children feel confident and competent to get enjoy being part of things, especially being part of the community. From our experiences, do we have examples of parents getting involved? Yes, we do. And all children have parents. Some parents want to be involved, some parents don't want to be involved, some parents just aren't there. But what we have had examples of is parents taking children down to, one example is in Glen Rothes Rugby Club, a child is exposed to street rugby, then gets taken down to Glen Rothes Rugby Club. His dad says, oh, I want to go down and see what's happening at the rugby club. The rugby club welcome him in, and he then gets a coaching qualification and is now coaching at Glen Rothes Rugby Club with the youth section. And his son has gone on and played for the senior part of it. That's how it happens. The sense of community that sport can give, and in my case rugby, is huge. So that's the physical literacy, the parental involvement, and...
You know, we've heard that parents don't always get involved in their children's education, especially if they've had a bad experience themselves at schools. And my question was really whether it's football or rugby, is the involvement in a sport more likely to get the parents involved in their children's development?
If I look at our clubs, and indeed many of our schools, especially in the school sector, the teaching workforce is supplemented by parents that want to help.
Okay.
That's a natural byproduct of it. What we are finding is that many of the adults who are now being involved have not experienced school sport themselves. So there's a huge education process that we have to do for that, to get them qualified to help the teaching staff. And we run a very extensive coach education programme that puts 4,500 people through coaching, and the majority of these will be parents. However, there is a large section of the community whose parents, quite frankly, don't care. And we've got to make sure that we cater for them as well.
Yeah.
By quality coaches, and that's where we can put people in.
Dundee High School.
Dundee High School is the rugby playing school in Dundee. However, we've been engaging with them around about outreach programmes into wider community to widen that and broaden that base of rugby. We're having particular success at Harris at the other end, at the west end of the town, but we need to look at that at the moment, and we're in discussions with Dundee High School at the moment because the development officer has just recently moved on from there, so we're appointing another one, and that's part of the wider Dundee City piece that we want to do.
Do you have something to add to that? Yeah,
yeah. I was just going to add a wee bit about one of the programmes we've run recently, which is engaging with the parents. Now, because obviously we're in Fergusley Park and football tends to be a male-dominated sport, there was an issue in Fergusley Park with the parents bonding with their children and also being able to cook on a meal on a health on a budget. So we ran a programme. We've run it a couple of times now. We called it Buddy Hell Kitchen, and we got local fathers to come along at 4 o'clock after school, who went to into our hospitality suite and used the kitchen, were taught how to cook a meal on a healthy budget, a healthy meal on a budget, while the children were actually inside playing football or sport inside our air dome. When that went on for an hour, and then the children came over for the second hour and spent the time with their dads, actually eating the meal which their dad had prepared, and that was a bit of bonding, helped the bonding, the child get health benefits, and the hook was, it was quite acceptable for a dad to come to the football stadium, whereas it might not have been if it was something, maybe a council kitchen or something else, a school kitchen, it wouldn't have been acceptable, whereas it became quite, shall I say, sexy to come to the football stadium for a father, and it was very successful.
Well done.
Mm-hmm. My original question.
I think the question about outcomes is quite a difficult concept for us to really understand. And I would acknowledge what you're saying, Stuart, about there probably not being enough work to show us what methods are most impactful. I think the biggest impact that we have, though, for young people is making them feel involved in a community. We deliver a project actually at Maxwell High School, one of our key schools. We're there for 6 months, embedded in the curriculum. We run it across all the schools in Dumfries, and the school partnership is vital to us, really understanding the needs of the pupils, the needs of the community, and we give them interdisciplinary learning across performance, but ultimately we're looking to get them involved in a major carnival, and the carnival sort of includes 4,000 people. So to get them involved in that and actually sort of teach them theatre skills, design skills, acting skills, is how we do that. But actually, the impact for us is often not them excelling at a particular discipline. It's actually making those young people feel part of a wider community celebration, and. Going back to your point about parental involvement, I think if the model can work, so we spend 6 months getting them involved, and then we have a major celebration, and we also have shows and events that perhaps for that community they couldn't really afford. So we've got a task force that goes round and offers free tickets, but the relationship between the pupil and the parent is really important, because often they'll tell us, well, because he's then that, then I'm quite interested in coming to see that show. So there's all sorts of different outcomes that happen.
Okay, can I just follow on as well? What Colin's already mentioned about leadership in schools, it's come up quite a lot. If the head teacher isn't interested in engaging, we tend to not have a crossover of work. Now, I'd like to ask the organisations involved, how do you feel? Could you do more work working with local schools or local authority? Do you have examples of it? Well, Colin's already given us a couple of examples, but do you have examples where that's actually worked out? And would it be beneficial for you to get that access?
Before anybody comes in on that, Ruth, can I ask you to maybe give us your views on the original question about the activity of the arts and theatre sector in
well, and broadcasting, I suppose, you've got much experience in that, in making pupils actually interested in, you know, getting involved in education.
Well, I'm actually here, Convener, really as the chair of the strategic group for the Creative Learning Plan, rather than in my professional capacity as a journalist. And in a sense, we've been talking a bit about partnerships, but in order for the Curriculum for Excellence to work in the way it was structured, it has to concentrate on creativity in the sense that creativity has been knitted through all parts of the curriculum. It's not just about expressive arts, important as these are. So, I mean, this, which I'll leave with you, which we produced. This involved a partnership with ourselves at Creative Scotland, College Development Network, Education Scotland, the GTCS, the Scottish Qualifications Authority, Skills Development Scotland, Association of Directors of Education. In essence, we were all trying to get together and say, well, if we mean what we say, we've got to make sure that in all of our professional capacities, we try and ensure that creativity is not just introduced to students, but importantly, is introduced as part of teaching practice. And one of the nice things that's come out of all of this is that both the SQA and the GCCS have now got qualifications that are specifically about teachers imparting knowledge creatively or indulging with the students in creative activities. But I know you're interested in evidence of how this works so that it's not just mouth music. And the portfolio manager for education and young people at Creative Scotland, I know, sent you a paper which has got a number of got bibliography attached, but I draw your attention in particular to a report that came out in it's actually an American report, but it's important because it's a longitudinal longitudinal studies, and they you know, they found that that with people, well, I mean, the report was called The Arts and Achievement in At-Risk Youth, which in essence often meant people from a deprived background. And, I mean, the results are really quite remarkable because, you know, almost half of the people from these areas went on to college or university, which was a kind of quantum leap in what you might have expected hitherto. But just going back quickly to specific examples here, as you know, I mean, you all know about Sistema, of course, at Raplock and now in Govan Hill. There's an Aspire project in Dundee, again, which is working with 9 schools in the most deprived areas there. And we also use the cashback programme for creativity, and that's helped us giving access to positive creative experiences for a lot of kids. The Youth Arts Strategy, which was just published, Time to Shine, I was interested in what you were saying about letting the young people decide the programme, because I think that's really, really important. So we've created at Creative Scotland 11 youth arts hubs all over Scotland, and they're designed and run by the young people to their own agenda. And of course, the government provides a lot of money every year for the Youth Music Initiative. And I think that's really important because there's a huge body of evidence about how learning any kind of musical activity and an instrument impacts on self-confidence and self-belief and classroom attainment levels, and so that gives us, you know, that gives 40,000 kids every year a guaranteed year's music tuition up to primary six. So there's loads of stuff going on, but from my own experience, if you wanted specific experience, we've run several days where we've involved both the staff and from schools and our friends in the arts sector, because there's a huge number of partnerships, as you know, between major arts organisations, including all our national companies, and schools working together, and it's really quite exciting. And one of the days that we had, I won't bore you with all of them, but one of the days we had at the Science Centre, because we wanted it to be a kind of fairly sexy environment compared with the classroom. And the day was recorded by very young school children on their own laptops, and they made cartoons of the day, they made films of the day, they made storybooks of the day, and it left us feeling frankly inadequate. But it did show that how if we can use not just creativity per se, but creative means of teaching to enthuse young children and get them interested in subjects which might have appeared dull before.
Okay. Can I go back now to George's question?
Did anyone want to... Leadership of schools and how you can work with them?
George, at the moment... Our programme is delivered at night time needs based. How the whole programme works, we'll sit on a daily basis with a community safety team, work out where we should be, working with young people. We're most at risk, how it works out. It's just street work all the way, doing football activity. Small percentages we manage to get indoors. While we're on the street, we're finding the needs of the young person, whether it be a social work case, a police case, whatever that is, we pass the relevant places. Now, there's a lot of times that we're finding kids, you know, below the ages of 8, 7, 8 years of age who have issues, you know, have problems, we've got to pass it on. We've asked on occasion, can we take the programme into the school? Now, us working away with community safety team, they deliver a programme within the school called a Safe Kid programme, which we deliver at the club. It's a workshops, you know, on all these different parts. The kids come to us. Us trying to get into the schools, but we're met with a no. No, you can't get in. You're not part of what we would say is the council establishment. We're a street programme. We're a third party. We're on the outside. But we're working with 25,000 attendances every year. If we can get to the kids in the schools earlier for the job that we do, we could make a bigger impact. But we're met with a no. No, you can't get in because you have to be either part of a hub, you have to be part of this, you have to be part of that. Well, tell us how we do it so we can get in, because we want to do is to do the job safely and efficiently with the kids as early as possible we can get, so that they don't end up down the route of what the older brothers or the older sisters have done or the parents have done over the years. We're trying to get it quicker and a lot earlier within the schools, but at the moment we're sort of met with a no, so we're trying to get around that.
Okay. Yeah. You know, the good work we've done in the schools in Dumfries and Galloway has taken us a time to build a reputation so that teaching staff you know that our work is of good quality. But I echo what you're saying about trying to get access to the school. It really depends on the management, whether the management and then that example, the head teachers just really embraces any involvement with the school. But some of the other work I do across Dumfries and Galloway is about merging the arts through our own hubs. And the same thing keeps coming back to us, in that when we're inside the schools, now we're there, they tell us we're dying for activities to do, but we just never hear about it. And then meanwhile, back with the arts sector, with the artists, they're telling us we just can't get into the schools. So we've been trying to combat that, and of course our region's quite wee, so we can get round it and try it, but we've been trying for a couple of years now to get access to the inset days that the teachers have. And they'll tell us, no, there's no way you can do that, because that's dedicated for SQA time, which for us illustrates the potential that's there. But I think if we were able to do some community development stuff with teachers on a time when the kids aren't there and bring partnerships together, I think it would be really advantageous for all sectors.
Could I come back on that? Yeah. It's just that one of the ways in, I mean, there are programmes like that which we've all been familiar with, but one of the ways into it is that 30, I think it is now, of the 32 local authorities are part of the creative learning networks, and the job of the person running the creative learning network in their area is to make marriages of convenience. So they know what the arts opportunities are out in their community, but they also have connections with the schools, so they're able, if you like, to broker the kind of relationships that sometimes it's difficult to do just from the outside. So yeah. I think they're, and sorry, just sorry. Quickly, there's another thing worth looking at, which is for all schools, which is a creativity portal, which Creative Scotland has up, and it's been running now for quite a couple of years, and means that teachers can access that and see for themselves what's available and what they might want to dip into or not, and it's really very useful. But there is resistance, and I understand the resistance, because you know there's the tyranny of the timetable, you know there's having to deliver aspects of the curriculum, and there's still, I think, quite a lot of teaching staff who are still slightly living in a silo rather than understanding that cross-fertilisation actually helps attainment in their subject as well.
We're quite fortunate in that all the head teachers that we work with, certainly the five that I've been working with closely over the last 4 or 5 years now, are really, really supportive of our programme. I think to teach leadership, firstly at a young age, they have to be confident. The work that we do with the pupils, they've already come back and said that 95% of them, I think, in the last bit of research we conducted, said that they feel more confident. And in order to teach any pupil to become a leader, they have to have that from a very, very early age. So even if it's little things like just within your sessions, you're delivering with S1 and S2 pupils, you're just asking them to take ownership for part of the session, whether it be delivering a little part of it in terms of a warm-up, whether it be providing them with little tasks when you go on trips or you have to go on events. Those are really, really sort of early parts and early stages of development, and that's the sort of key to leadership for us at that young age. When they then step into sort of S4, 5 and 6, then we can start to engage in them with a little bit of coach education. And that's generally when we start to then look at them using and working with the school football teams. They might just be going running a team along with a senior member of staff or an employed football coach who can lead it, and they'll just be there as an assistant. And that's probably quite key for us, and that's probably the really, really early steps for us. I think for a kind of real-life example, one of the schools that I currently work with, which is New Battle High School in Midlothian, we have two or three pupils already at S1 who are volunteering with the local football development officer, who's Keith Wright, on his holiday programmes and his Easter camps. So for a pupil at 11 and 12 years old to already be putting a hand up, asking to go and contact the local football development officer, then looking to go and engage with them and just act as an assistant coach. Now, they might not have an awful lot to do there. They might be at the holiday camp picking up cones and counting numbers, etc., etc. But still, to go and do that at that age and to be given that level of responsibility, that's a really, really important life lesson for me. And then leading from that, there's a number of pupils at New Battle again who, as part of the Sky Sports Living for Sport, they've been the ambassadors for the school now. And again, that's pupils who've come through the school of football. So.
Thank you. I'm going to try and move on because we've got quite a lot of people. Yeah, okay, quickly, Josh.
One more question. Basically, probably covers both the arts and sport as well. It's we have obviously the sports hubs and we have arts hubs as well. Is there not a case to be made that we could maybe more formalise them in a stage where they do have an engagement with education and attainment as part of their kind of remit as well? Because basically, you guys are the ones that the young people, the education are finding difficult to reach, are the ones that they're coming to. So is there not a way, like we could possibly, like use St Mirren's example, have the sport there as the hook, but you could be linked with UWS and the local college, West College Scotland, in order to kind of get access to education, should you get these young people and put them down that route? Is there not an argument to be made to where we join this all up and we start looking at these hubs and making them like arts hubs, all feeding into the kind of education system as well?
Okay. Brian, Stephen?
Sorry. I'm only going back to experience here, speaking about the hubs that perhaps in our area. We're not seen as a sports-based club, although we work for St Mirren Football Club. The programme that we deliver... Right, but no, but no, they're no, you know, you're right. But they're not seeing the programme that you deliver. We don't okay at the weekend, John. What we deliver is a model to engage with young people, to take them on. But if we speak to the people who actually run the hubs, you say you have to go through all this criteria. But if we want to take that kid from the street to then get him fed into a hub, which into a sports-based club, we've then got to ask that kid to pay X amount of money to join that establishment. Now, working with the kids that we're working with in these areas, they can't afford that. You know, the times of poverty, we can't ask them to do that. So we've got to try and create something for ourselves to then have something in the hope maybe one day they'll accept us into these hubs. But again, it's like education. You know, you either get in or you won't get in. It's the same as that. They either want you there or they don't want you there. So it's for the sake of the young people we're working with, we have to look at it a wee bit better. Having a bigger hub where everything is in one place, yes, it would be better, because then you can say, well, that's for maybe the kids, maybe not get the full package, but still get a touch of what they want to go with, and then the kids who are maybe the flyers, as we would say, can be maybe taken down the path within that whole structure. To me, it sounds a better idea.
Okay. Chris?
Yeah. I think if I'm understanding the question correctly, I think the key thing for us, our programme is S1 to S3, so in order for us to try and take that where it links into colleges and universities, it's quite difficult at the moment. If the funding is there for us to run this programme through 6 years of high school, which, in fairness, a couple of schools have taken that on board, Gracemont High School being one of them, that would be fantastic for us. I think what we...
I'm kind of using the Spartans idea as an example, mm-hmm. where Spartans have local over here in the East Coast have kind of made themselves almost like a community education hub to a certain degree, and you know, that's what I'm talking about. You know, it's
there is again the work that Spartans do is absolutely fantastic, but again, a lot of that comes down to the funding that they do externally and the sponsorship they manage to raise to allow them to go and do that, to employ the staff to go and engage with that. I think, first and foremost, given the resources that we have, if across, certainly for our programme, the work we're doing this year with Dynamic Youth and Youth Achievement Scotland, that's massive for us. The pupils that come into our programme are going to have roughly 180 sessions a year in S1, 180 sessions a year in S2, but it's not a recognised subject for them. The schools recognise it as a subject, and they'll take part in it every day, 5 days a week for the S1 and S2, and potentially S3, but for that they don't achieve anything up until this year, where we've started to engage with Dynamic Youth. So now all our S1 pupils are going through Youth Achievement, which now sits and is accredited by the SQA. So for us, that's a key one. And as I said, we piloted it last year, and this is the first year we've run it across Scotland with all our S1s, and we should have, we're
hoping to have, I think, around about 80% of our pupils through some level of qualification from that.
Ruth?
Just very briefly, I mean, part of the building blocks of the creative learning plan are about going along the route you're suggesting. It's about removing barriers. It's about making sure that arts organisations understand the need to get involved with education. Part of that is the youth hubs. So there's no... the youth hubs were set up because they were set up relatively recently within the last year. I mean, they kind of post-date some of the previous demarcation lines that we've heard about. So I'm fairly confident that the links are there and are being built on.
Okay, thank you. I know that everybody wants in, but I'll come back to you first. I'm going to go to Chick first and we'll move on, but I'm sure you can answer some of the points that have been raised earlier.
Good morning.
My next answer.
First of all, we all recognise, I think, the work that you're doing in both sports and the arts. And as a South of Scotland MSP, I'm aware of the work that Graham and his team are doing. There is a dilemma, as far as I'm concerned. One, we have sport is not one of the eight curriculum areas, but arts is. So I can just concentrate on sport, if I may, to begin with. How clear do you think it is that current sporting initiatives are leading to improvement in young people's engagement with basic learning and school education? What evidence is there?
I don't think there's much
evidence. Full call answers. There's also another academy in Dundee, which is Morgan Academy.
Yes, that's right, absolutely. If I can go back to your question is about sport specifically, and where we have to get to, there has been physical education, physical activity and sport are happening in some cases in isolation. So physical education is, correct me if I'm wrong, one of the compulsory elements of education within Scotland.
Just to clarify, it's, yes, but it's within the health and wellbeing.
Health and wellbeing, yeah. It's not
criteria. So it's not identified as a separate individual specifically in one of the curriculum areas. ARPS is, but sport is inside health and wellbeing.
Yeah, I mean, within that, the Scottish Government recognises the positive impact through the health and wellbeing that physical education can have on learning. But yeah, and where's the evidence?
Well, I think you've heard a lot of evidence today through a lot of initiatives that are happening that sport makes a difference to people's lives. There are plenty of, you know, you go and type it into any research database, you'll find it. Ofsted did a report in July around about the impact it has on attainment in England and Wales. There's many research studies being done within Scotland as well. Round about, go back to John Pelichick, Tom Renfrew in the Linwood Daily PE scheme back in the early 80s, whenever I was at college, taking part in it. So PE, physical activity and sport, under health and wellbeing, does make a difference. Where's the evidence? Well, the evidence, as I say, is you go back to Daily PE project in Renfrew in the early 80s and have a look at the raising attainment and attendance and attainment and behaviour within schools. And you've heard anecdotal evidence today of schemes through football, through arts, that do make a difference to young people's lives. And that's
no, I don't disagree with that. It has an impact. And I'll come back to some things, particularly, if I may, in arts in a minute. It does have an impact, and hopefully a beneficial impact. I'm trying to relate that to basic learning and educational, you know, basic educational attainment. And there's no real link, is there?
I would disagree. There's a huge link. And yes, that might be anecdotal, but from my experience...
Sorry, there's no evidence of the benefits that that has.
You ask any primary teacher the impact on her children, or his or her children, after they've had a run about for an hour, and coming in and being able to sit down and get on with that academic study. The evidence is there. It is, ask teachers. The problem is we have teachers that are, and I like the expression, the tyranny of the timetable, you know, because, you know, maybe we need to step back from achieving the wider achievement and recognition that attainment is more than just academic success. And for a lot of people, it's about, and the Curriculum for Excellence talks about, it's a values-laden curriculum. And, you know, sport, there's many values in sport that correlate to the
the curriculum that we have to push forward. You know, physically competent, confident children that sport can do and the arts can do. We've talked about it this morning.
Ruth, yeah. Because I mean, it seems absolutely clear to me that's the case. And if we look at through the other end of the looking glass, if you like, if you look at it from employers' points of view, and you look at what employers are saying currently they want in people, and they want people who are good team players, they want people who are able to work collaboratively, they want people who are innovative, and they want people who are confident. And all of these things, both sport and the arts, deliver in spades. So, you know, the evidence is really... just forgive me, but I refer you again to... because I'm not going to open up all the links, but but the portfolio manager did send you a bunch of links of which gives you kind of outcomes, chapter and verse, of how the arts have improved. But I'm speaking as a person with dodgy knees because of all these years playing hockey. I absolutely agree that sport delivers the same kind of values.
Yeah, I think you're like myself in terms of... you know, sport at school and encouragement of parents to balance that with educational attainment has helped, at least in my opinion. But just going back to the expressive arts part of the curriculum, but if we look at the features that affect both sport and arts, I mean, we've talked about parental involvement, which is critical. We're looking to also to narrow the attainment gap and look at those that are you know, come from deprived areas. And of course, involved in the arts and in sport, as I said, parental involvement, but there's also time, there's also finance, and there's also the danger of overarching expectations that can be created in these areas. I mean, do you think, coming back to my original question, are we actually achieving that balance in Europe? And I'm not decrying the initiatives. I think they're great, and it does involve more people. But, you know, coming back to the basic learning and narrowing the attainment gap, and given these features which impact both sports and arts, are we achieving the balance? Colin. Go, sir.
Yeah, that's an interesting... viewpoint there. I think that some of the things that frustrate me quite a lot when I go into schools, is, particularly secondary schools, is that they have the expressive arts curriculum and that split between music, art and drama, mostly some dance as well. But the frustrating thing is you walk into the classrooms in a music room and there are 28 children sitting with headphones on learning individual music tuition, because the schools have defined that as, okay, well, you learn... You'll have to learn this to pass this course. But I think what's much more effective is when we use maybe community music models, where we're getting young people to come together and, you know, get away from the kind of classroom setting and just actually be expressive. If they're allowed to be expressive, I think there's an opportunity that they can actually learn. For example, if over three classes we're going to create one piece of samba, that would take three classes to do that. But the skills that they learn in creating that piece of music, playing all different parts, are actually, going back to what Ruth said, it's about discipline, it's about organisation, it's about understanding that you have to practice something to make it okay. But after those three sessions, you can move on to something else. Difficulty is you go back in the classroom and they're still stuck on those keyboards. And what we're trying to do is try and energise that approach for teachers. And often what they tell us is that our presence in their schools is helping to inform their practice. And usually we go in and naturally we're an asset and they say, can you do more? But of course we are restricted. But I definitely think we have to balance this idea that, and I'm not decrying music tuition, because music tuition is great. We've got some brilliant musicians. And I do think we need to balance a little bit of individual tuition in terms of reaching our talent. But I would prefer that our cultural offer in schools is much broader and much more about inclusion.
Okay. Ruth. I think that's right. But one of the points I would make is that there's a lot of evidence that teaching, however creative the individual teacher is missing a trick by not responding to the way that people learn now. And our children learn in a wholly different way from the way that my generation learned, and they learn through a whole series of different platforms and modules and so forth. So there's one thing stuck in my mind which might address your point about specific attainment
allied to this, and it was written, if memory serves, by a chap called Derek Robertson, and he was talking about a class where there were a couple of kids with whom I have every sympathy who were completely bored by maths, and the teacher in question used found that they were addicted, mildly addicted to Guitar Hero, which was not something that I have about my own laptop. But anyway, he utilised their interest in that to fire up, you know, different mathematical strategies, as a result of which they didn't become mathematical geniuses, but they did pass their exams. And I think there's a lot of areas where we need to listen to, watch how children learn and respond to that, and not try and force feed them information and material the way, you know, which is by and large yesterday's news.
Okay. Yeah, Colin and then Brian.
I think if we go back to closing the attainment gap, it's what the question was. And if we look at the health and wellbeing curriculum, I think there are lots of great examples. You've heard some today, especially in sport. But I think what we've got to do goes back to the physical literacy, the long-term approach and the joined-up approach that has to be more common practice across more schools than it currently is. So there are lots of great initiatives going out there. There's lots of good progress in PE. There's lots of great progress in active schools. There's lots of great examples of how sport can link with education, and where it works with the head teacher, it works. However, there are not enough. That should be the norm in every school. And that's the challenge, is that we move good initiatives and good practice to make it common practice, where we have leadership buying into it. And so to answer your question, do I think we are further down using these activities to reduce the attainment gap? No, I don't think we are, because it doesn't happen as standard practice.
Okay, Brian.
Can I just talk a wee bit about the educational attainment? We actually run a programme which I've been on to the council about for a number of years now, because I felt there was a real opportunity for the football club to run a programme for children who are leaving school at Christmas, who are winter leavers. The schools don't want them there, the pupils don't want to be there, and they're a disruptive influence to the other pupils. We've started the last 2 years doing a programme where we're bringing these children to the football club. The hook of sport brings them there. We give them some football activity. But on top of that, we do CV building. We do interview techniques. We teach them first aid at work, give them the qualification for that. We give them health and safety. So they're getting coaching certificates. So they're actually building a CV over those last 2 or 3 months on a day, 2 days a week, coming to the football club. Now, that only helps. These kids are probably the hard-to-reach ones that we're talking about here, who would potentially be leaving school at Christmas, wasting 4 or 5 months of their life and getting no qualifications. But they're actually coming out with some activities, something on their CV, which shows makes them more job-ready, which is a huge benefit to them. It's also a benefit to the schools, because the children who are trying to attain educational qualifications are not disrupted by these children who potentially are not really interested. So hopefully that actually can act as a springboard to help the ones who are left in school the 5 days a week to actually achieve better qualifications, because they're not getting disrupted by other pupils who maybe aren't really interested because they're leaving school on Christmas. And I think it's the hard to reach children we need to look at here, and how we can use sport to bring them as the hook, to bring them and educate them and send them out of there so that they're potentially better off and job ready is the one for me.
Okay, thank you. Liam.
Thanks very much. It's partly picked up actually by Brian's last comment. I mean, I think we've heard both in terms of sport and arts that it has an intrinsic value, whether it's in terms of providing young folks with things to do, an opportunity to bond with fathers or parents, an opportunity to improve their learning across the curriculum, in other ways getting them ready to learn in other environments. But we've had a challenge in terms of parity of esteem in the way that academic and vocational qualifications are sometimes viewed. And it strikes me that there's a challenge here in what we're talking about in raising attainment, that we don't necessarily know how to value or give credit for what young people are achieving in the sorts of environments that you are involved in and that those initiatives are helping open up. I mean, are there examples that we can look at that give us a better handle on how we give due value and credit for the achievements, for the attainment that young people are succeeding in, whether it's in the arts or whether it's in sport and physical education?
Can I start with Colin, please?
I'm maybe going against the grain here, but I'm a big fan of the work of Carol Dweck, and anyone who's read her Growth Mindset book, where we should be focusing on the process, not the outcome. And when you talk about attainment, we always talk about the outcome, be that a qualification, be it and I'd far rather that we focused on the process of, if we've got our curriculum for excellence and we know what that's trying to achieve, what is the process to achieve that? And a lot of the softer skills that we talk about in the curriculum for excellence, around about children being responsible, safe, healthy, achieving, nurtured, active, respected, responsible, included, they come through sport, they come through arts, they come through processes, and Ruth's quite right, the benefit of maths teacher that presents her subject in a different fashion. These are the things that we need to be focusing on, and then attainment will go up. And I think it's, we need to strike a balance here between the process and working on the process, because I believe innately every child has got the ability to develop, to reach certain standards if they're in the right opportunity, given the right set of circumstances, given the right process to help them learn. And we should be focusing on the process and not necessarily the outcome. And I would just like to say that.
Okay, Ruth?
Yeah, I think that's great. Just briefly to go back on that, because I think sometimes what happens is, I think young children have got fabulous imaginations, and sometimes it seems to me some parts of some of their schooling kind of squeezes that creativity out of them rather than nourishes it. But, we've got examples now, they're small examples of where the GTCS and SQE are beginning to understand that you sometimes out-of-school activities involve perhaps in environmental projects or in theatrical projects or whatever, that these can be utilised both for staff recognition for staff qualifications and recognition for pupil attainment. And I think that's really quite important, because learning's not about, 9 to 4. It's about holistically about everything that you expose a child to in their own environment.
I'm interested by the comments you make, and it is sort of counterintuitive, your argument, Colin, about process rather than outcomes. But what Graham was saying earlier on about the ability to engage with teaching staff through in-service days, etc., seems to be being inhibited by almost a lack of value or an undervaluing of what it is that you and other groups are able to deliver through that, as opposed to the stuff that SQA sets down and almost needs to be taken on as rote, and through continuous professional development needs to be kind of upgraded, that we need to take a slightly more nuanced approach to what that continuous professional development and development of teachers' professionalism and skills is all about. And that's where I'm not sure we're capturing well enough what it is that you've all been talking about. There's clearly great examples going on across the board in Scotland, and yet that attainment gap has remained stubbornly wide over successive administrations and successive initiatives.
I'll just give you one sentence in response. I think there is lots of room for the SQA to loosen its stays a bit more.
That's not a good image that we're left to be honest, but
delete it. Take Graham. The message.
I get the message though, Graham.
I think the point you're making, Liam, is very well made, actually, and sadly the only reports that we can really draw are written by Arts Council England, certainly for our sector, going back to 2000, which was basically trying to understand the value of inclusion. But the problem is with the inclusion against it, to support attainment, is it takes so long, it takes a life cycle for us to understand what the social asset impact is on that young person. So maybe we do need to sort of think about partnership ways of measuring, both in sports and arts, culture and any activity, how that's actually impacting on people. I'll tell you this once, though. I walked into a school, and it was very recently, and it's a school that has really low attainment, and the head teacher welcomed me and my team and said, let's get one thing straight, we're not interested in attainment. And that was quite an introduction to our team, because basically what we were able to do there really quickly was stop suggesting, okay, we can support your drama students to get better exam results, we can support these guys. And what that did actually was mean that the enriching process that the young people got at that school during that 6 months was probably the best work we've ever delivered, because we were working on skills that could help young people, and we were working with teaching staff, asking them what are they learning in classrooms and how can we add to that. So it was this cycle that went on, and I think when people are really honest about that and you know, let us do our work like that. The other part I need to make is that most organisations that are here today probably have very, very low capacity in terms of, it's probably 2.1 staff, if that, project staff. And I don't think that the sector that are delivering the work actually have the resources to then go and measure that work. And that's a big problem for our sector. We just don't have the capacity to do that.
Can I just look at a couple of points?
Firstly, see, when we're talking about achievement, I think, given the experience I've had in the last 7 years working with young people, achievement means something completely different for every young person I've met. Sat in a meeting yesterday with a young boy who achievement for him will be being in school still within the next 6 months, because his behaviour within our programme within school has been that poor. And that for him will be a massive achievement. And we'll lose the chance to engage with him when he steps out S2 or S3, because the programme doesn't continue beyond that. But for me, that would be achievement. And I'm not even looking at attainment. I just want to make sure that young boy stays in school. Because if we can do that, that provides him with a chance to go on and sit some form of qualification when he goes in S4, S5 and S6. So you look at that from one aspect, and I've got the other aspect. I've actually got pupils in the programme who are very, very intelligent. And then we look to use the programme to really try and just enthuse them to stay in school, to make sure that attendance is really, really high. And then their achievement then becomes on what qualifications we can try and help them get. I think now that the schools have been buying it in our programme, we're starting to now roll out S3 with a lot of the schools. It actually provides us now a chance to shape how this S3 programme is going to look. And if I think to the work we're doing with Craig Royston and Grace Mount in particular at the moment, they've both looked at S3 as opposed to just going in there and the people just playing football once a day. It's how we shape the learning during that period, so when they then step into S4, straight away they're ready to go and sit a National 4 or a National 5 in PE. Now, a lot of these people, boys and girls, are people who you wouldn't probably be looking at presenting them at that level, but the fact we're getting to work with them at S3 and we can now actually devise our programme, that might be something that I think in the long term for us might be a chance, might be a way in which we can kind of close that attainment gap, certainly with the boys and girls we're working with.
I'm going to have to stop you there, because I've got a number of members who still want to get in. Time's against us, Colin.
I was quite interested in the evidence supplied by the SFA. Admittedly, it seems to be mainly connected to the School of Football, but there does seem to be a lot of assertions there about engagement of the young people as opposed to attainment. Is there any evidence that the evidence of engagement that's shown here in terms of football extends to other sports or to the arts?
Almost we always ask our pupils to go and engage with extracurricular clubs. I think when a young boy or young girl is coming into high school in S1, yes, if they're involved in our programme, they're going to get football 5 days a week. But for us, for me especially, they have to go and be involved in other sports. There has to be other aspects of their life. Because when they're that age, that you're looking at that general broad education, you're looking for them to go and develop themselves as a person. I think there's real-life examples of that. I think there's a young boy, Daniel, who was at Newbattle High School, for example, who, after S1 and S2, his real passion was music. And when he's offered the chance to go into S3, he actually wanted to go and step in and take music on board, so stepped out of football completely with our full support. I know he's now down at university in Leeds and completing a degree in music. So there certainly is a lot of cross-curricular work going from our programme.
I think you're talking about anecdotal evidence here where you have knowledge of individual cases. Is there any body of statistics that have been gathered, figures, anything that would support the fact that young people are engaging more with learning and with school-based education in other sports and in the arts?
To be honest, I'm probably the wrong man for that question. That's probably where my colleague Donald, who should have been here, would be far more versed to answer that. I can only really speak from the experience I have, which is probably a wee bit more localised than working with the schools that I have, but I think they do. I think the engagement comes from comes across a number of factors. I think a lot of it leads from the staff that we put in place who lead in schools on a daily basis to make sure that they're going and working with the rest of the school staff to make sure they are engaging in a number of other subjects.
Wanted to come in.
Organisations in the cultural sector, Creative Sparks, definitely Edinburgh-based, who are gathering evidence across most of our key venues in Scotland, and Creative Scotland supports that piece of work. And it's basically looking at the behaviours of audiences, and in some cases there's been some evidence to show where active participation is happening, then there's a broader level of engagement to the art forms itself. For our own organisation, and I will provide evidence if need be, but we've gone up to our fifth major celebration, and the work that we've done in the deprived communities of Dumfries has had an impact. Just by matching the postcode, we can see that audience is now starting to buy tickets, and it's happening at a rate much quicker than we anticipated. That said, there's an awful lot of investment that we're doing in that community to achieve that.
Discussing there is evidence of participation in the arts, as opposed to evidence that by participating in the arts, it leads to young people having better engagement with school education and with learning in general.
I think, at the risk of repeating myself, I think that what's quite clear is that the young people engaged in the arts in school are, by virtue of the kind of skills they're learning, are much more employable at the end of that. And I think maybe if we were to put the same question to the CBI or somebody like that, they would say that the end product, if you like, the young person who goes out of school and university will display enhanced qualities because of that. But Graham mentioned earlier on that, you know, if we have a specific event like the Festival of Dangerous Ideas or something like that, then it's easy to measure outcomes. But on an ongoing basis, there are very few organisations who have the resources to, in addition to what they're trying to deliver, to try and do an in-depth study of impact as well. But I think everybody that you've listened to this morning, I mean, we've all spent a lot of time in a lot of places with a lot of young people, and the experiences in my case have been uniformly positive, and the reaction of the teachers to how these people have blossomed has been uniformly positive. So I think the problem is not that they're trying to find out if it works. The problem is trying to find a methodology of proving to you that it works.
The difficulty for this committee is we're always looking for evidence, and without an improvement in engagement, we're not going to get an improvement in attainment. You know, that's a simple fact. How can we measure this? I mean, where can it be measured? We all have this feeling that participation in sport, participation in the arts and so on is a good and positive thing. We all have anecdotal evidence that it seems to be a good thing, but we haven't got the hard facts.
Because class is hard facts. Because attendance records at school.
Because it's part of it.
Because if you look at attendance records, certainly for our programme, your average attendance in S1 and S2 is around about 92%. Whereas the average attendance for the school football sits around about 96-97%. So in terms of engagement and making sure that the pupils that we work with are in school on a daily basis, then that for me is the first and foremost part. And that would be a fair bit of evidence, I would have thought.
I would just refer to your evidence where you say that the attendance in school is an average of 4% higher for school football and non-school football pupils, which is significant, but it's not a huge figure, is it?
Oh, I'd say that's pretty big. I mean, 4% when you're looking at the course of 180 days in the year is a fair number of days to miss school. I'm not a mathematician at all, but I think that would be a fairly high number. And I think, again, when you look at the individual cases, and that might start going down to the anecdotal evidence which I was talking about earlier, but when you look at some of the individual cases, we could have a total of 96-97% for the school of football, yet we might have two pupils out of 12 whose attendance is 60-70% purely because their home life and their social environment is that poor. So then if you take that into consideration and we still yet have a 96-97% total, then I think that then paints a sort of bigger picture for it.
I think the measurement question is a very valid question. How do you measure these things? You know, the impact of the environment, the school, the home, the intervention within arts, music, sport. It's a very difficult thing to measure, but I would welcome, a research into this area, because from anecdotal evidence. You hear it all the time. Now we need to move the anecdotal into actual, well, this is what we're doing, this is the results. Surely we can go around the schools that have got recognised sport and music programmes, and we can do a government research round about, well, what are the benefits? Are the children that are in these cultures, in these environments, are they attaining more than others? Maybe that's a piece of research that needs to happen.
Ruth?
I'm not sure if we're allowed to ask the committee members questions, but I mean, I would throw back... I would throw back at you. I mean, imagine what would happen. I mean, measure what would happen if these kind of programmes weren't happening, because they're absolutely vital lifelines for a lot of young people. I mean, I spend a lot of time at a part of Glasgow where you see kids being dropped off at, you know, Saturday morning music school and whatnot by parents who are really involved and really supportive and all of that, and they've got their, you know, their violin case over their shoulder and whatnot. What we need to provide is for all the kids who don't have that supportive home environment or don't have the money to have these. So all of these things, the Youth Music Initiative and all of these programmes, the youth hubs, the sports clubs, all of these programmes keep kids, I'm not going to say on the straight and narrow because that's ridiculous, but they do keep kids in a positive framework. And that, to me, is at least as important as a piece of paper with an exam result on it.
I don't doubt you're absolutely correct, and I don't think anybody around this table would argue anything but the fact that sport and the arts, you know, do enhance the experience of pupils and turn out a better well-turned person. It's just back to the old thing: evidence. How do you produce?
Is a well-turned out person not evidence?
Yeah. How many of them? How many of them?
Yeah, and the difficulty is as well is that I don't know about your work, but most of the hard-to-reach young people we work with have this kind of resurrection point, which is way after school, and it could be when they're 21, 22, and they come back into the work that we do, and they're ready. It's like they've matured, but had it not been for the introduction they had in second year or third year, they wouldn't know that we exist. So it's about making that a very brief introduction to them at some point during their development, that you can come back at some point if you have gone off the straight and narrow. And it's whether we actually focus to make sure that we have these community resources that are there to deliver that. And I welcome the idea about a community hub, and I wonder if it's maybe something that our future schools should be looking at in more detail. As you know, I just find it sometimes quite galling when we have these really high-profile art centres that are in urban, you know, are really kind of well-to-do areas, but why don't we have that in some of our most deprived areas? It's obvious.
Okay, I'm going to, George, a very quick supplement.
A very quick one. To follow on from what Colin was saying, is it not just the case that, like, the West of Scotland cliché is that someone from a working-class background, it's rock and roll or football. You know, that's always been the way out of poverty. And is this not just a case of repackaging everything that's gone on before? Because that's why there's not much actual evidence as such, because it's been going on for time immemorial from a point of view, but it has worked in areas. It used to be the churches and uniformed youth organisations that did it, but now it's been branded slightly different, and we're actually aiming for to try and see if we can get either educational attainment or attainment, just career path in general, because that was one of the things that was brought up last week by one of the building, the contracting companies, was the fact that surveyors, was that they talked about the career path of the person, which wasn't necessarily academic. You know, it was to go down the idea of just either a trade or something else as well.
Does anyone disagree with that? No. Well, yes, I disagree that we're repackaging an old song, because you know, it's a quite, if you look at some of the most successful companies in the world just now, the Googles and the Apples and all of these are full of free creative thinkers. They're not full of people with a batch of advanced hires.
Brian, Stephen.
The problem we are getting, we're faced, and all great education in schools, but a lot of the kids that we're working with on the streets, again, back at night time, is a lot of the kids have dropped out of school. They don't have education. They can't even spell. To say Carol Dwyer, you know, people wouldn't even understand who this was, let alone spell it. But these kids, you know, they still need somewhere to go, somebody to trust, somebody to know they can open up to, and that's being with them all the time, you know, working with them. I think the beauty, again, coming back into the football set, or the football club, or the sports industry, is the club itself, they've got a lot of links into the wider businesses. So we're bringing in kids through work experience, school-based programmes, linking them through sport and art. We do like photography classes at pitchside on match days, so they're linking them with national media. But then the business is there. But we're asking these people, for the kids to get a chance to go on who don't have the qualifications, but knowing the trust of the links that they've made through the club, they're taking that chance with the young people that they're never going to get. Going to the job centre, oh, you're not going to get it on your CV. The CVs are the same, but you're trying to change it a wee bit to give them that experience, which is real life experience. And this is what the kids need, but you're trying to use the sports side of it just to give them that, you know, and that's obviously the values that we're getting from it, and the guys are getting the same.
Okay, Mark.
Thanks, Kevin. I just wanted to ask a question about cashback. Can that cut across the programmes that most of the panel members operate under, whether that's diversionary activities, whether that's funding for sport facilities, whether that's cashback for creativity? And I wanted to ask the question in the context that we're under today about addressing the attainment gap, reducing inequality. Do members of the panel think that the funding for cashback for communities is targeted properly? Do you think that with a renewed focus on tackling inequality, those hardest to reach young men and women, that cashback funding being spread over the whole of Scotland is actually the right approach, or whether we should be focusing in the same areas that the government is on the attainment fund?
Has never received cashback funding, so a very interesting question for us, really, despite the fact that we've actually applied, but I'll leave that for another committee. There is something that you've said there that I'm slightly anxious about, actually, that the Attainment Challenge Fund seems to replicate, certainly for our sector, what Creative Scotland are doing with the Youth Arts Hubs. In fact, the 11 Youth Arts Hubs are included in some of the areas that are included in the same fund, and I bet again that some of those communities are benefiting from the cashback. And I think we need to be very careful that we're not just seeing a league table in terms of poverty and saying that's where that exists, because certainly from our community, our young people are living, I feel, in an acute sense of poverty, because they're often quite isolated. There's nothing around them for maybe 50 miles. So I worry about that, actually, that we're just going for the target zones too much.
I don't think we've got to be realistic about this. Creative Scotland gets £3 million for cashback for creativity over 3 years, you know, and in a pan-Scotland context, that's going to be spread pretty thinly.
Anybody else? Sorry, Stephen.
For myself, the funding based on the programme, we had to apply to local area committees to receive funding for the programme we had to run. Only that there was a part with Scottish FA this year. We managed to receive some money through Scottish FA and cash back for the Midnight League programme. A small part, but again, the amount of money that gets delivered through the whole of the country, it doesn't go a long way, but it gives you a small part. But the way it goes, to me, it should go locally and not nationally into these bodies, because I think it would be better coming into the local area. Then it can be divided up better, instead of going, let's go into the main pots and then let's see where it all goes for there to be fed out that way, because I think it would hit the areas a wee bit better.
Chris, did you want to go on?
Yeah, just I think the money, the cashback first and foremost is vital for us. It's absolutely massive, the funding that we get. In terms of the inequalities and the areas that are spent, when we were provided with the funding, we looked at the areas and where we wanted to spend it. And I think if you look at the table, the Scottish Multiple Index deprivation table, we have schools of football in the top 10 areas. And that was one of our targets that we set ourselves. And we looked at these areas. That's where we need to get into. I think then when you're looking at how we spend it there with the school of football, it is an S1 and S2 programme in the main. I have had a discussion with a head teacher recently about whether or not he thought that programme should change for his school and become an S4, 5 and 6 programme. The difficulty being that you then have missed 3 years of engagement with these young pupils, and the difficult pupils that we're getting in from these difficult areas, making sure they stay in school till S4. If you don't engage with them S1, 2 and 3, then you lose that chance. So I think we've identified the right areas in terms of local authorities. I think we've identified the right areas at the moment for our programme. And what we're seeing now is that the schools are now starting to see that and starting to try to match the investment from cashback with their own investment to make sure that programme can then continue in S4, 5 and 6.
I know the programme, again, going back to what we do, diversionary based, harder to reach areas, about the colleague's saying. Is it no then something, again, that looking at the partners within the area to see, OK, if S1, S2, we're doing this, who's in the area that could do the same thing, that could work with these harder-to-reach kids, could then take that programme on, S3, S4, because S5, S6, we're then looking to take these kids back into employment because the harder-to-reach kids are the ones that may be missing out. But if you're then working with them in the establishment within a partnership approach, it's going to be better for the young person, and obviously, collectively, it'll make the programmes work a lot better. But again, being faced with that challenge, no getting your foot in the door first, it's trying to get to that part.
Okay, sorry, Colin.
Cashback funding we have received and is gratefully received, and it's against certain outcomes being set, which we deliver against, and external evaluation round about that. We focus the money back to communities and across 32 local authorities. So we try to get the money down to where it is, round about club development officers, working with partner organisations to employ club development officers, to put in place 30 schools of rugby, and from that, and diversion activities, and from that, we then use that money and money of our own as a multiplication to get further funds out of local authority. And it's the partnership approach, as I go back to one of the points I made earlier, things generally work when you have strong partnerships in place and when you have leadership around about education especially to make it work, and then you can bolt everything else onto that plan. But without cashback funding, we wouldn't be in a lot of places.
Okay.
Again, back to these other sports, again, it's great to hear all these kind of things working, but back to diversity-based activities. I've been running a programme 6 years in the Renfrewshire area, and I'm yet to be working at night time with all these other sports. You know, is it something that could be brought back into the streets at night to give these kids out with school another opportunity, out with the education system, to get back onto the streets for these kids who'd not get any opportunity to go after school or be involved in these clubs, who then don't want to be pushed in because they can't afford it? Give them something that's on street-based, it should be there, but they're not getting a chance to do it because the funding's not getting put in to the places it's where it's needed for the kids on the street at night.
OK, thank you. Gordon.
Thanks, convener. Can I say that I'm already convinced that sport and arts does have a positive effect on children's well-being and their education attainment, whether it's about developing and reinforcing people's skills, or making them more confident, or improving their self-image. You know, they can only have a positive effect on people's education. But what I'm keen to understand, particularly about the arts, but also in sport, in my own area, in my own constituency, I'm fortunate in that I have Whale Arts in Wester Hills, which do a fantastic job with the local community. I also have the Big Project, who sang at the opening ceremony of the Olympic Games from the Broomhouse area, both areas that I would describe as having challenges. And what I would like to know is, I've seen the benefits of these two projects in my areas. What, apart from finance, what are the challenges you guys face in rolling out the provision that you currently have to other areas? And what would you say was the soft skills that you help improve when you come into an area to young people?
Again, many challenges that you'll face. That I think one of the first thing ever when I went into an area, it was a case of who are you, why are you here, why are you coming to work with me? You know, the kids, you've got to build trust up with them before they'll start to work with you, start to open up and then realise what their backgrounds are. And that is still things, it's taking time, but for every 4 years you move on, there's a new group that comes through and you've got to keep working away. As far as the, you know, you could throw money all day to programmes, to projects, and it would never be enough. It would never be enough to fix things. But it's, kids have to trust you, believe in you, understand that you're going to help them. And if you've got a team of people that's prepared to do that every single night, every day of the week, where they stand on these streets, where they're going to be, they'll come back at you and they'll change, because we've got proof that they are changing, they are getting into employment, they are running programmes, they are taking charge. So you have to still be there, but they have to understand you, that you believe in them, because they're living a chaotic lifestyle. You know, they live for day to day, you know, minute by minute, you know, so they want to know there's somebody that actually cares for them, first and foremost, and then you start to get the best out of the kids. So it's picking that person first. We can pick a sports coach who's great at putting a drill out all day, but you have to get the person who can understand the person, understand the kid, understand what they're going through. And if you can understand what they're going through, you'll make a difference to the life of that kid and you make a difference to the community. And that's the most important thing, as we see through sport. Sport's sexy. Yes, it's great. You can get them involved in it. But if you don't care about the kid or the child, you're never going to win. You never make a difference.
That same question in Dumfries and Galloway through our Arts Hub kind of process about, you know, what are the challenges that people are facing, and something really interesting came up actually, which was that specialists like youth arts people or youth development people, that actually they're a very specialist worker, because they embody both the youth worker and the the artist or the leader in their field, and they're quite hard to come by actually, because they might have a good talent and can inspire and motivate young people to achieve and to take part, but it's for us often the best work is where we have qualified youth staff with us, and that can be costly. So I suppose our sector responded by saying we need to have a more rounded development pathway for us as practitioners, so that when young people present you with problems, that you're actually giving them the right advice, and that you actually, because you know, when you, I mean, I deliver face-to-face youth arts work in our company, and always will, some of the stuff that comes at you is not about the sport or the art. It's about benefits. It's about my pals going through this. And I think it's about us. We have to make sure that the people that are really delivering this across our country are actually qualified. Going back to the skills that they learn, and I'm sure my colleagues will talk about their skills, but the idea that to you know, increase their creative thinking skills, it's hugely important for us as a nation to develop that, because... you know, when our parents were younger, and maybe with some of you guys, but, you know, you knew which job you were going into. There was a pathway. There was an apprenticeship. Most of the young people I work with now, 25 to 30, have had about 10 or 12 jobs already, even just being at uni. So we really need to sort of support our young people to be creative thinkers and to be flexible, so that the jobs that come up when they're older, they'll have that very important thing that they need, which is creative flexibility, you know, that they can actually adapt to those situations.
Yeah, I think I would say that the two things, well, three things you need, but you need leadership. You know, leadership's absolutely crucial in a school or in a club or in anything. You need leadership. You need the kind of proper professional skills that Graham's just flagged up to go into that. But, I mean, I'll give you two examples where I think that... There is, and Dumfries and Galloway seems to be getting a lot of good publicity today, but it happened that there was an expressive arts teacher in Dumfries and Galloway who managed to persuade our Heidi to come off curriculum for a whole week, obviously out with the pressurised running to the exams. But the whole school was then able to do a project for that week and get it. So everybody was involved, and I think that's quite important too, because just like... with academic skills, everybody's gifted, but they're gifted in different ways. When Scottish Screen was alive and before Creative Scotland came into being, it did a project in Fife on filmmaking, but it meant everybody, all the kids, whether they were sewing the costumes or whether they were making the scenery or whether they were behind a camera or whether they were acting, everybody had a buy-in. Everybody was part of that project. I'm sure you find that all the time, Graham. So we need enough people who have got the schools to make that happen in schools, and we need people in schools to be sufficiently receptive and sufficiently confident to come out of the tram lines, because one of the things we found at Creative Scotland, one of the shortfalls we've got at the moment, are enough teachers with the confidence to teach creativity and to teach creatively, and that's going to take time. I mean, it's not that old a curriculum.
Colin.
Yeah, I mean, I just echo all that's been said. For me, what I'm hearing is good old-fashioned teaching skills, and good old-fashioned teachers, the good ones were the ones that spent an awful lot of time with children, and they were the ones that usually got the result from children. I'm sure you can all remember your own teachers. They're generally the ones that went over and above and spent a lot of time. What we've got to accept is, in the modern world, the chaotic world, the different challenges in this world, is that where you can get teachers that are teaching beyond the curriculum. And by that I mean the people, the inspirational people that are working on the streets. They're not might be teachers by profession, but they are absolutely teachers in the way that they go about their business. And it's about people and developing people and getting people to spend time with children and make a difference to young people's lives. And that's the biggest challenge, is to get more people out there who can think creatively, and also to open up the confines of education to be receptive to that. And going back to my earlier point, where that happens, it works very well. Where it doesn't happen, you have this silo mentality of things happening, lots of good initiatives, but it doesn't change culture. And I think what we're looking at is a change of culture here.
Okay, thank you. Chris?
I think in terms of the softer skills that we're touching on first and foremost, but the big role for us working with the children at the ages that we're working at is teaching them to be confident first and foremost. I think that's a skill in itself. I think any child who has a level of confidence where they can stand up and speak in front of a group, where they can speak to an adult and be polite and be respectful and speak to an adult, that is a massive skill. I remember having a conversation with a university lecturer who was doing interviews for pupils who were applying, and it's not what they have on their CV that gets them in the interview, but it's then having that confidence to speak, having a passion to speak about something they've been involved in, and that for me is a massive soft skill. The amount of time these people spend in our programme, the understanding of commitment, I think that's something that seems to be disappearing very, very quickly in society at the moment. I've always been taught, when you commit to something, you commit to it, you see that through. At the moment, certainly within football, it seems to be you commit to something and it doesn't quite work for you, you step out of it. And again, that's something over the last kind of 2 or 3 years with our young people, we're making sure that they're aware that when they step into the programme, they're making a commitment for 2 years, and there will be rough times in those 2 years, there'll be challenges in those 2 years, but they have to kind of see that through. So those kind of softer skills for us are massive. In terms of the challenges, there's always a challenge when you step into a new school for the first time, when you're telling when a teacher finds out that they might be losing some of the pupils for a period of the week because they're now going to go and play football. That is a challenge. That challenge is always met with ourselves, a chance for us to sit down and discuss what the impacts of our programme is. The fact that when we looked at our programme, when they changed to the curriculum for excellence, we had to sit down and go through our programme and look at, well, what outcomes and expectations do we actually hit through the School of Football? And we had to sit down and show that. We had to put together a curriculum map to show that we actually hit these E's and O's across probably 6 or 7 of the areas, which is massive for us. So that becomes a challenge, but it's one that we've met, and every time we seem to manage to turn everybody around. The other challenge is engaging with the parents. That's huge, and I think that's something I never really got a chance to touch on earlier on, but the way in which we engage with parents is massive. Because the programme sits in areas of real deprivation, getting those parents into school can be really quite tough, so we need to look at ways in which we can do that. So the first part is any pupil that comes into our programme, they have to go through an interview process. So you're then looking at a pupil at 11 years old, P7, coming in with our parents to sit through an interview. Very, very informal interview for a P7, but that first step is really quite important for us. There'll then be an information night when the pupils are selected for the programme. You'll engage with them through whether it's nutrition evenings during the year, whether it's the school reports. So we have a presence at every single reporter night in school, so the parents again have a chance to meet with us. So it's providing them with 3 or 4 different opportunities where we can get a chance to actually sit down with the parents and discuss how we think their pupils doing and how we think we can engage with that pupil to make them a little bit better.
Okay, thank you very much. Can I thank you all for coming along this morning? It's been a very interesting session, and has been very helpful in terms of our inquiry into educational attainment in its widest sense. So clearly, we've still got a lot of work to do on this, and we'll be carrying on with our inquiry over the coming weeks and months. But once again, can I thank you very much for taking the time to come along, particularly Chris at the last minute. So thank you very much for stepping in, and can I suspend briefly? Okay, okay, we'll move on to item three on our agenda. Our next item is to receive an update from the Scottish Government on issues arising from the Continuing Care Scotland Order 2015 and Aftercare Eligible Needs Scotland Order 2015. We considered these affirmative instruments, I'm sure as committee members will remember, at our meeting on the 24th of March this year, when the Minister committed to providing further information. So, welcome back, Minister. Can I welcome Fiona MacLeod, formerly Acting Minister for Children and Young People, to the committee, and also David Blair, Head of Looked After Children Units, Scottish Government. So, welcome to you both this morning. Minister, I believe you've got a statement you wish to make.
A short statement compared to last time. Thank you, Convener. Good afternoon, committee. I offered to return to update the committee on two things. Firstly, the draft guidance on parts 10 and 11 of the Children and Young People Scotland Act, and secondly, to report on progress towards setting up the expert working group, which will consider specific policies on aftercare and return to care. And I'll be happy to take any questions after this brief statement. On the consultation on the draft guidance, from January to April this year, there has been a series of meetings, workshops and conferences involving local authorities, the third sector, practitioners, elected members and perhaps most importantly, care experienced young people, as we outlined to the committee in March. So far, there have been 22 such events attended by about 250 people. These will continue over the next few months, reaching a further 200 people. The workshops were jointly facilitated with the Scottish Through Care and Aftercare Forum. For our next steps in producing the draft guidance, we'll be incorporating feedback from these events, and it's now almost complete. So the next step is for both the draft guidance documents to be circulated to key stakeholders ahead of the next series of consultation events, which begin on the 7th of May. The draft guidance will be accompanied by a set of companion questions to help focus feedback specifically on the content and usefulness. And we will, of course, invite and welcome written and verbal feedback on these as a crucial part of us all working together to inform the final phase of the guidance development. I hope the committee feels reassured over the level of discussion and consultation that has been undertaken towards framing these documents and continues, and in a way that makes them worthy, these documents will be worthy of more detailed targeted discussion during the next phase of the consultation. On the expert working group, I'm happy to confirm that we have sent out invitations. The working group will look at describing additional cohorts of young people who could be made eligible for aftercare under the ministerial powers in Section 66 of the Act, in addition to the return to care commitment made by Aileen Campbell when the Act was going through Parliament. I'm able to confirm that a wide range of key stakeholders, including local authority children and family and housing teams, third sector organisations, including the coalition members, CELSIS, COSLA, the Scottish Through Care and Aftercare Forum and Social Work Scotland have been invited to be members of the working group. Subject to diaries, availability and the capacity within these organisations, I hope that the working group will meet for the first time in May to agree the terms of reference and also the membership of a wider consultative group to support them in the work they'll be doing. I'm asking the working group to support the Scottish Government in mapping the resource and operational requirements of any proposed extension to aftercare eligibility and to help us to describe a brand new policy on return to care. As you'll appreciate, we discussed in March that developing these policies will be a massive undertaking as they require flexibility and consideration of capacity in the system as well as the current financial climate. I will task the group with reporting to either myself or whoever is the Minister by the end of this year, but I'll expect them to inform me if this is an unrealistic timetable given the enormity of the task that we're undertaking. Now, the committee, I know, is aware that the timeframe already set out by Scottish ministers on the 14th of January last year was when we announced, the minister at the time, and I quote, a number of measures to support care leavers over the next 10 to 12 years. So we will work with the group meeting, hopefully in May, as I say. We will task them with trying to be able to set a framework and report by the end of the year, but I want them to tell me if that's unrealistic. But I must remind committee members that this is a plan that we want to put in place over the next 10 to 12 years. So in conclusion, Convener, can I say again, I'm sure that we're all aiming for the same positive outcomes for our care leavers, and I look forward to continued productive, collaborative working on these issues with the stakeholders, with the young people and with the committee. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister, for that update. Clearly the committee had some concerns on the 24th of March with some of the evidence we received and also some of the comments we received from outside organisations, particularly the Coalition, members of the Coalition for Continuing Care. I'm going to ask members now what questions they wish to ask. I'll begin with Liam MacArthur.
Thank you, Convener. Good afternoon, Minister. You referred there towards the end of your opening comments to the fact that you would want the members of the working group to advise you probably in early course if they felt that the time frame that they've been asked to work to was unrealistic. You'll recall from our previous exchange that there were concerns there that in terms of the local authorities, it's clear that they have put up some objections to some obstacles they believe exist to delivering what we thought as a committee and as a parliament we'd help put in place in terms of the passage of the original Act. Can you be a bit clearer about what the hurdle is that those suggesting that the time frame being proposed is unrealistic would have to get over if you were to be persuaded that putting in place or coming forward with firm proposals for extending the coverage of these provisions by the end of the year is not to be achieved?
I'm not aware of anybody saying that the timescale is unrealistic. I'm just very aware of the huge task that we're going to ask the working group to take on. And so I think I just wanted to put a marker down now that I don't want to say to the working group, you must have completed everything by the end of the year, if in trying to meet a timetable of the end of the year, they don't take the time and the care to make sure that this is realistic and it's deliverable and that everybody has the capacity to do what we want to do. And also remember that this is within the time frame of extending eligibility over a 10 to 12 year period as the Minister and Parliament accepted last year.
I think we'd all accept that getting it right rather than necessarily getting it done by a particular deadline is always going to be more important. But I think we recognise there will be different opinions within that working group. And therefore, what I wouldn't want to see is the message from yourself as Minister, from the Government, to that working group that you anticipate the timetable being very stretching and what you're asking possibly undeliverable by the end of the year, and therefore for those who would quite happily put this off for a bit longer, feeling emboldened to make that case, while there'll be those in the group who are very keen to keep everybody's feet to the fire in terms of delivering that extension of eligibility.
That is not the message I'm sending out. And if you, you know, I listed all the different organisations that are going to be part of this working group. It's a very balanced group. You know, which nobody will have, it will work as a group. That's what I really want to see.
Yeah. I think the other question I had, I mean, obviously during the exchanges last time round, there was reference made to the non-statutory guidance, which came as something as a surprise that this had not been shared by with members of the Coalition at that stage. And I think there was an undertaking given by yourself at that committee meeting at the end of March that this would be remedied and rectified as a matter of urgency. So I was slightly confused and a bit concerned to note in Mark Ballard's email to committee members last night that while welcoming the establishment of the working group and the invitation to themselves amongst others to form part of it, he goes on to say we hope that the first meeting of the of this group will also give us an opportunity to view and discuss the non-statutory guidance that was also mentioned by the Minister at the Education and Culture Committee meeting on the 24th of March. I have to say, I'd rather assume that following our exchange on the 24th of March, that non-statutory guidance would have been passed on to members of the Coalition and others within the week certainly before the end of that month, and that clearly doesn't appear to be the case.
I think there seems to be conflating the two issues here. The draft guidance, there has been since January of this year, there's been 22 events covering workshops, conferences, one-to-ones with organisations, 22 events from January to April. The next one will be on the 7th of May. Each of those events has been part of the process of producing the draft guidance, so it's live guidance. You know, it's an iterative process. And for the next meeting on the 7th of May, the latest iteration of the draft guidance will be going out to everybody.
It appears as if that guidance, and my recollection was that the first iteration of it, the first draft of it, was produced around September last year. Maybe wrong, but it was around that time. Yet Mark Ballard, on behalf of the coalition, appears to be suggesting that they're looking forward to an opportunity to view and discuss the non-statutory guidance that was mentioned by the minister at the meeting. Now, that to me suggests that while they may be part of the iterative process, they clearly haven't been presented with the latest iteration of it during the course of those many meetings which you suggest have taken place.
22 events over a couple of months, and every time all that we're learning at each event is fed in. So the latest iteration of the draft guidance will go out to IBDI that's going to the 7th of May meeting. Now, that is still being worked on even up to this weekend when I was yet again going through it, reading it, asking questions, making my comments on it. So this really is a live process. So everybody's been involved all the way along the line. I mean, I'm trying, if I can quickly scan this. I'm looking at dates in March, I'm looking at dates in April, and on, as I say, you know, working towards this meeting on the 7th of May.
So what you're saying is that at those meetings, the latest iteration of the guidance will have been presented to those participating so that they can comment, feed in and suggest where amendments need to be made.
Yeah.
So the next meeting will not be... it will not be the first time that they have seen the raft of non-statutory guidance that was referred to in the meeting on the 24th of March.
Yeah. So, I mean, as I said, what we're doing is every time we have these meetings, it comes back and then we can send it out again, not necessarily the full draft guidance, but another list of the latest meetings have raised questions, have thought of other ideas. Can we put these in the mix for the next meeting? But I know that for the 7th of May, they are going to get, you know, after all this 4 months of work and all the questions come back, feed in more questions. We've been getting CELSIS to go through this, is that right? CELSIS have been going through the feedback from each of the meetings to inform the questions we ask at the next meeting. But on the 7th of May, they will get the latest iteration of all the many pages of the draft guidance just beforehand.
Apologies for labouring this point, but just to be clear, that it's not just that they've been informed of the issues that have been raised by themselves and other stakeholders at these meetings, that at those meetings they have been provided with, or since the 24th of March, they've been provided with a copy of the latest consolidated non-statutory guidance in a single form, even if they're made aware that this is obviously not a final version, that will be subject to the consideration of the working group in due course.
No, what I was looking at over the weekend is the final many-page version of the draft guidance that they will get out for the 7th of May. What we've done for each of the meetings has not been produced the document each time, but is to set the questions to feed into what goes into the final.
I have to say, I find that slightly disappointing. I mean, certainly my expectation from that meeting at the end of March was that the non-statutory guidance that had been produced, as I say, around about September last year, would be presented to not just the coalition, but probably other stakeholders as well, and that would then inform their input into those discussions and meetings, which are very much welcome having taken place. But to some extent, you're asking a series of questions of people who haven't had the benefit of seeing where the guidance stands at this point, even if the expectation is that it may change radically, it may not change greatly before it's finally agreed. And right. I think that's against the spirit of what I understood was the undertaking given by you, Minister, when you appeared before us in March.
The 22 events that I talked about that have been held between January and March, that timetable was already in place and had started in January. It had continued throughout February, throughout March and then into April. There's no point at that when you're in an iterative process where you are at every meeting, you've got the practitioners there, you've got the providing authorities there, you've got everybody there at different meetings. There's no point where you can produce a whole sentence and say, this is what all the meetings have decided. What you're doing throughout that process is saying, these are the questions that the meetings are raising, leading towards what I was looking at over the weekend, which is, here is the draft guidance based on what we have been working on over now 6 months, more than 6 months, and that's what we'll look at on the 7th of May.
But unless they see sight of where that guidance stands at any one time, yes, they'll be able to respond to the questions they ask. As you know yourself, Minister, you can only question the information that is in front of you. You can't question the information that's not in front of you. And it is only by looking at the non-statutory guidance as it stands, even if it's in its draft form, that you can answer the questions that have been asked of you, but also comment on those things that may, for whatever reason, not be being asked of you, but on which you have perhaps very strong views.
But when the invites go out to each of the meetings, it's clear what you're coming to the meeting for, so that you've got the opportunity to learn from what has gone at previous meetings, to think about what you think about it, to feed that in, so that your input into that meeting on that particular date feeds forward into the next meetings. The point of the way that we're doing this, and it's very much based on the way that we've done other stuff in the run-up to the Children and Young People's Act, the way that we went out and consulted with as many people as possible, involved as many people as possible, and that, my understanding from the backbenches was that the Children and Young People's Act, in the way that it came to Parliament, was one of the best examples of working with all stakeholders as much as possible to inform what we finally printed to actually produce as the bill. And that has been what we've done in this process as well. It's also very much part of the whole process of how, we do the guidelines that we're producing now are based on experience that we've got and guidelines that we've got going back many years. So this isn't all sort of in a vacuum. This is all part of very much a live process that has now been working for many years, where everybody comes together, works together and feeds forward constantly.
But you'll be aware that when we were discussing this last time round, that actually what the Act said and what what was being proposed and in fact what was then passed in the standing orders were not seen in alignment. So actually seeing the detail of what this non-statutory guidance says is vitally important. Yes, the process leading up to the introduction of the bill and the consideration of that bill was seen as fairly exemplary, but there were opportunities for us in consultation with the Coalition and others to make amendments, make changes and all the rest of it, but we had the text in front of us. We were able to comment not on just the things that the ministers wanted our views on, but on any issues that we thought were relevant. And what I can't understand is how you can have this consultation process going on. The meetings, I'm sure, are very valuable, but you'll only get answers to the questions you ask rather than comments from the stakeholders on the breadth of issues that may arise through the non-statutory guidance, unless they have a copy of the consolidated non-statutory guidance.
I don't think that's an accurate representation of what's happening, because this guidance that we're working on is working from a history of guidance in this area. So when the sectors come together at all these 22 odd events, they are coming very informed about what they want to see the guidance becoming. They're coming informed. They know they're coming from, I've already used the guidance for a lot of support for these care leavers, as we have already, which they were, had been part of producing. I'm not going to apologise, Convener, for the way we've done this process. I think this process has been one that has really involved everybody, all stakeholders. has given them every opportunity possible. I was out at Who Cares Scotland last week, and none of these concerns were raised by me. What we had was a very strong discussion about where we can go forward based on their experience of where we've been, where we are, and where we want to get.
I think, to be fair, Minister, you were quite accurate in terms of the process that led up to the bill. I mean, and everybody in this committee, I think, and others outside Parliament felt that. The problem I think we faced as a committee was that the evidence that we received from your officials was somewhat confusing, shall we say, on the 24th of March. And that's left us with certain some doubts. I would like some clarity. You talk about a process that started in January and is ongoing. Your official on the 24th of March said it's been ongoing since last autumn. It would conclude by the end of April. It's obviously not going to happen now, I presume. You said that everybody's been involved and there's been all these meetings. The organisations that Liam and others have referred to on the 24th of March took quite a different view about their involvement or lack of involvement. And so I think the concerns that the committee expressed on the 24th of March led by the confusion that I think was established in the minds of the committee members by your officials, to be absolutely blunt about it. And that left us with some questions about why organisations hadn't been involved, why there'd been a consultation and they hadn't been included, what was going on with this non-statutory guidance, etc. All of that stuff was, I think, effectively why we asked you to come and give us an update to try and clear up some of these questions. So I think it's entirely reasonable that we try and nail down some of the questions that were raised by the evidence on that date. Can we be clear then, the consultation that you're talking about starting in January and ongoing at the moment, is that different from the consultation that your official Caroline Uni was talking about that started last autumn, or is that the same consultation?
It's in phases. So phase one from October to December 24 was the public consultation on the draft orders that we looked at and passed when I was last here in March. And the consultation on that fed into, and what we learnt from that, fed into phase two, which was the January to April 22 events. I'm quite happy, I've got a whole list of all the events and who was at it. I'm quite happy to send a copy of that to the committee, if that would reassure you.
I think that would be helpful.
That when I say it was 22 events with 250 people.
There's no doubt about that. We absolutely believe you. We're just trying to clarify, because there was some confusion on the 24th of March. Thank you for that. Mary Scanlon.
Can I just say I share the concerns of the convener and Liam MacArthur, but just two fairly short questions. You've said several times today that you've had 22 events, that's between January and today, so pretty well an average of five a month. Now, I would have thought that you would be making considerable progress, but in your opening statement you talk about more detailed, targeted discussions, and you talk about the enormity of the task. And I actually thought that we were making some progress and coming to some agreement. And then that was followed when you said you would report by the end of the year. And I think you used the word maybe unrealistic. So my questions are, you also mentioned the implementation over 10 or 12 years. So first of all, what are the main problems? I mean, why there must be a few stumbling blocks? You know, why is it that you've got 22 events with, you know, every man and his dog involved in this area attending these events, and you're coming forward with different questions and feeding into this in phase one and phase two and phase three? So what's the main stumbling block? Why is it going to take till the end of the year, or maybe even longer? So my questions are, what can we expect by the end of the year? Is it possible that it could even be extended beyond the next election, when this committee would have totally changed? I certainly wouldn't be here. And what are the stumbling blocks? Because obviously no member of this committee is party to the discussions, but I think it's fair, although I wasn't on the committee taking the evidence in the children's bill, it was my colleague Liz Smith, but what's the big problem and what's the reason for confusion between officials and the government? And why is it you've got 22 events and a whole load more planned? What's the stumbling block? What is it that can't be agreed on?
Right, we're conflating two different things here. It's the guidance that we've had 22 events on and 200 odd people.
Asking about
the end of the year is a target that we've set for the expert working group. Now, the guidance is about guidance on implementing the statutory instruments that we passed at committee and in Parliament in March. The expert working group is at looking at, can we extend continuing care and aftercare to an extra cohorts of care leavers? Two completely different things.
Problems. Why do you need so many further meetings and delays?
No, it's two things. We're working on the draft guidance to support the statutory instruments that we passed. That's what the 22 events have been about and which we will continue to work on so that we get the guidance to support the statutory instruments for continuing care and aftercare for young people who are in care but can continue to be in care from their 16th birthday onwards and perhaps be eligible up to their 26th birthday. That's the guidance to go with the statutory instruments. The expert working group, which we're hoping will be able to come back with at least, you know, sort of firm ideas by the end of the year, if that's realistic, that expert working group is going to be looking at extending continuing care to extra cohorts of young people, not just those that we've already agreed who will get continuing care and aftercare after their 16th birthday. So it's two completely different issues.
So is the end of the year realistic? Is that when...
Well, that's why I said in my statement, I hope that that's realistic, but I don't want to put pressure on an expert working group to come forward with ideas of which extra cohorts of young people we could extend continuing care and aftercare to. I don't want them to come back with that unless it's realistic that there is the capacity in the sector to do it, that in this financial climate that we can do it, and that it will fit in within the commitment that the Minister gave over a year ago, that this is a 10 to 12 year process of actually extending the cohorts.
Okay. I don't think there are any further questions, Minister, so can I thank you very much for coming along this morning and giving us the update. No doubt we will follow this process with interest, but can I thank you once again for your commitment to come back to the committee and keep us informed and for coming along this morning. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And with that, can I close the meeting?